has directed that the Central Vigilance Commission should complete its inquiry into the allegations that have been leveled by the director of the Central Bureau of Investigation and the special director of the Central Bureau of Investigation, Shri Alok Verma and Shri Rakesh Asthana, respectively, within the next fortnight, 12th of November to be precise. But they are to do so under the direct supervision of a retired judge of the Supreme Court, Justice retired A.K. Patnaik. The acting director, Mr. Nageshwar Rao, has been told he cannot take any policy decisions, quote unquote, and that all the decisions he's taken very late at night, a few days ago, are to be examined by the Supreme Court, and the rationale is to be given in a sealed cover before the 12th of November. And Mr. Rakesh Asthana's petition was not heard by the Supreme Court. Now to get back to agriculture. You are entitled to your opinion about the judgment, but let's begin our thing. And we are running 15 minutes late. We have, you heard in the first session, individuals representing the government, the corporate sector, banks and financial institutions. We have a different set of people for this session, and we're going to look at the extent to which the food systems and agricultural systems in this country are under pressure. I'm very happy to welcome, and I'll request them to come and take their place on the dais, Shri Viju Krishnan. He is the All India Joint Secretary of the All India Kisan Sabha. He's affiliated politically to the Communist Party of India, Marxist. And he's going to tell you about a little bit about the history of farmers' agitations in the country. And the next big bang, the big rally that has been planned in the national capital in approximately a little over a month from now. So he's going to talk about that. I'm very happy also to welcome Dr. Devinder Sharma. He's a food policy analyst, and we know him for his very, very interesting and some would consider provocative views on the state of Indian agriculture and the problems that Indian farmers face. And he's going to talk about the Farmers' Income Commission, whether that is more important, or universal healthcare education. Is it an either or do we need to balance these issues? Very happy to also welcome Ms. Kavita Guruganti. She's the convener of ASHA, and she's been very active in the forefront in issues pertaining to genetically modified organisms and food. And she's going to talk about a very, very important issue. That's the feminization of Indian agriculture. And we're also very happy to have with us Ms. Kiranjeet Kaur. She's a... there she is, please. She's a an activist, a farmer activist from Punjab. And she's going to talk about the ground realities and give you the true picture from the ground level. And so I'll request all the speakers to speak for approximately 15 minutes so that we have time to discuss, have questions and answers. And you're welcome to come here and speak or speak from wherever. Okay, we start with Viju Krishnan.
It has been 2 days of very important dialogue that has been going on here. And I have been asked to speak about the history of peasant struggles and the what the organizers choose to name as the Big Bang. Though that time and history will say whether it actually is a Big Bang. But all efforts are in the direction to make it a very successful protest to ensure this government, which by far the farmers feel has not addressed their issues, will see reason and take some steps in direction of mitigating the suffering of the farmers. Friends, actually, when this particular government came to power, It was probably no government in recent years has been able to raise the hopes of the people as much as this. I think ever since the Garibi Hatao slogan of Mrs. Gandhi, I doubt if any other set of promises have actually led to a immediate impact on the electoral fortunes of a political party as the BJP has benefited in 2014. So what were these promises? Literally, the entire wish list of farmers was on the manifesto of the BJP. If I would say the Charter of Demands of the All India Kisan Sabha, but for land reforms, all other issues were more or less mentioned and listed in the manifesto of the BJP. And in over 400 meetings, public meetings, the Prime Minister himself, in many places physically present, in many places through his 3D images projected to the people, these promises were repeated again and again. So we as a country, when we are speaking about the food systems and the condition of the farmers, in over two decades, more than 3.5 lakh farmers have committed suicide. And yes, whether there was an agrarian crisis under the UPA, there was an agrarian crisis then too. And it is precisely that which was very nicely articulated by the BJP, and they managed to get the support of the rural population during their electoral campaign. What has happened after? Probably no government has failed as miserably as keeping these promises or meeting these promises once they have come to power. That is the impression that people who have been working with the farmers have been getting. In the first 2 years of the Narendra Modi-led BJP government, literally people say it's the honeymoon period, and there were no much protests in that time. I would like to take the example of Haryana, which has been showcased as one of the success states of Green Revolution. In the month of April, May in 2015, I visited Haryana, the villages of Haryana. More than 60 farmers had committed suicide. But what has led to this kind of a situation? Even before this 2015 April itself, when just probably a week after the government came to power, we met the agriculture minister and said, please implement your election time promise of ensuring MSP at C2 plus 50 and assured procurement. He very openly said, that is just an election time promise. Why are you taking it so seriously? This is what the election, agriculture minister mentioned. Later, the BJP president, Amit Shah, has said how it was an election time jingle and Chunavi Jumla. And very recently, we have all seen Nitin Gadkari telling that we never was were expecting to come to power. So we were asked to make the most fabulous of promises. So blatantly, they are able to, after having written and the Prime Minister himself having made speeches, they are able to go back on that. So in the last 3 years, it's actually 4 years, in the 3 years where the NCRB data is there, more than 36,000 farmers have committed suicide. We are talking about food systems. In 2016, October, I visited Maharashtra for a struggle. And I found a news item in Times of India, surprisingly, that in 5 month period, about 9,000 children below the age of 5 had died of malnutrition in Maharashtra. I thought it is an exaggerated figure, not correct. I looked at figures for the 1 year, just a year before that, and it said 21,000 children below the age of 5 had died due to malnutrition. The situation in Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, and so on is similar. the promises of the government, it also mentioned that there would be a scientific land acquisition, land use policy, and land acquisition would not happen without consent of the farmers. First betrayal was on that. They went with the ordinance, which almost done away with whatever limited safeguards were there in the 2013 Land Acquisition Act. And it was almost with such a confidence that it would go unresisted. And for the first time, the organizations of the peasantry, of agriculture workers, Adivasis, Dalits, came together and formed a broad issue-based unity called the Bhumi Adhikar Andolan with more than 300 organizations. We say issue-based unity because we don't agree probably on all issues, but on the fact that there has to be the consent of the farmers and food security considerations have to be kept in mind, and certain other such issues, also land rights, we could build this unity. I'm mentioning about the issue-based unity specifically because here again, it is talking about a food policy dialogue, and you have a wide variety, wide cross-section of people here. Very clearly, most of us don't agree on most of the things. We disagree on most of the things than agree on what we are discussing here. So, but these kind of dialogues and these kind of building issue-based unities are very much important. So this Bhumi Adhikar Andolan had massive struggles, at the end of which the BJP government was forced to at least put on hold the ordinance. They brought the ordinance thrice in the parliament, but they could not pursue it at the center. That was probably the first defeat that the Modi government had to face after they came to power. And ever since, there have been continuous protests which have been going on around the country. What are the reasons? The promise of the C2 plus 50. This is one important factor which has led, which we have been able to mobilize the farmers around. It was the Prime Minister's promise. He should have kept his word. They went to the Supreme Court, gave an affidavit that it cannot be implemented. States which were giving a bonus over and above the MSP, they said it is market distorting. So if you give more, for instance, Kerala for paddy gives a bonus of around 800 rupees more than the MSP announced by the center. Certain BJP ruled states like Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh also had some bonus. But these states were told if you give more than the bonus, more than the MSP fixed by the central government, then there would be no procurement. So it is a clear case of the government taking a position very clearly in favor of the market forces. And later on, over the years, we find one fine day, the note ban, demonetization decision. We were on a Kisan Sangharsh Jatha, and I had reached Anandpur, one of the hotbeds of farm crisis, farm suicides. And the very next day, in the market, we could find the farmers produce, there were no buyers. And that continued till all the way till Delhi, in Madhya Pradesh, in Telangana, in Maharashtra, in every state, we could find in the market the farmers produce. So ever since then, the price of all crops have only, which there has been a price crash, and it has, none of these prices have risen. That is the situation that we have found. And similar, at the same time, you find certain wrong policies like cutting the import duty of wheat from 25% to 0%, and you are having cheaper wheat being dumped from abroad, naturally much below our MSP. Why would anyone buy from the farmers? These kind of policies have accentuated the distress of the farmers. And massive struggles were built in Rajasthan, in Maharashtra, Haryana. Literally, most states, there were struggles. Maharashtra, we built a broad issue-based unity of farmers called the Sukanu Samiti. After a struggle for more than 2 weeks, the government came with some agreement. They agreed to some of the demands, but none were implemented for more than a year. In Rajasthan, Rameshji was mentioning about how increasing the MSP alone cannot be a solution. Yes, we also feel that increasing the MSP continually could lead to its own adverse impact on the consumers. But what has been done to reduce the cost of production? Input costs are rising. Total decontrol of agricultural inputs. The fertilizer prices are rising. The seed prices are rising. Farmers are using pesticides. Pesticide costs are rising. So there is no effort to control these prices at all. There is no effort to reduce the cost of production, cost of cultivation. So naturally, the farmers are bearing the brunt of these policies. I would like to also give some examples how certain crops, because it also is discussing about horticulture, cash crops and so on. I was looking into coffee farmers. Coffee farmers, I did my PhD on condition of farmers in India, and I was looking at the coffee farmers in Wayanad. At that time, the farmers were getting 20 rupees per kg of bean. And at the same time, you had a Nestle Blend 37 being sold at 5,600 rupees a kg. Today, just last week, we had a convention of coffee growers in Bangalore. And we have coffee farmers getting around 100, some places below 100, some places a little above 100 per kg. Nestle Blend 37 is selling at 9,600 a kg. So the profits for the corporate sector is rising, but the burden of price volatilities in the world market is being thrust upon the farmers. That is what we are seeing. So naturally, these policies have led to increased indebtedness. So we brought together, after the Mandsaur incident where six farmers were shot dead, more than 190 organizations came together to form the All India Kisan Sangharsh Coordination Committee on two issues. One is liberation from debt and ensuring assured remunerative price for the farmers. After a long countrywide march and a Kisan Parliament, for the first time, two bills were from this movement. The farmers developed two bills, one for liberation from debt and another for assured remunerative price. And today, both of them are in the parliament as private members' bills. So these are certain things which never happened before. Then we had the Kisan Long March. Rajasthan struggles actually inspired the Kisan Long March in Maharashtra too. In Rajasthan, we were planning to have a Mahapada with over 1 lakh farmers assembling in Jaipur, but over 1,000 farmer leaders across the state were arrested. And but the farmers sat on the roads wherever they were stopped, and within 2 days, the farmer leaders unconditionally were released, after which the government was forced to come to an agreement there. Inspired this by this, in Maharashtra, we took the call for the long march from Nasik to Mumbai, about 180 kilometers or more, starting on March 6th. Initially, there were about 12,000 farmers only. Farmers and a big number of them Adivasi cultivators. As day by day, we found that more and more people coming in. The first 2 days, the media almost ignored it, except the Marathi media who were there. There were some groups like News Click and P. Sainath's Pari was there to cover it. Otherwise, it was more or less ignored. On the third day, a small 47-second video of over 40,000 people marching through the Kasara Ghat, that became viral on the social media. It is only then the national media, so-called mainstream media, and I would say even a channel like Republic were forced to come. And they towards the end of the program, the Republic Channel person was trying to create a commotion in that, and he was claiming that he has covered the entire thing as though it is a big favor done to us. I said, you have been forced to cover it. It is the sheer strength of the movement that has forced them to come there. They could not ignore the movement. During this long march, you had women and men, the poor peasants, walking 180 kilometers in the hot sun. You have seen the blistered feet and bleeding legs, photos of this. It's the you could see the extreme distress that they are going through. It was a struggle against that, which was very successful, and the government representatives who termed it as termed them as urban Maoists were on the seventh day were forced to sit and negotiate with the same leaders and give a written agreement, and which was also placed in the assembly. So now, inspired by the long march, we are planning to have a march to the parliament from November 29th and on 30th, where across the country there would be farmers coming in here. There would be four points from around Delhi who would march to the Ramlila Maidan first, and on the next day to the parliament on 30th of November, demanding that there should be a separate session of parliament to discuss the agrarian crisis, to look into the two bills and ensure the passing of these two bills which have come from the farmers' movements, and to actually show a concern for the genuine issues of the farmers. For the first time, the struggles in the run-up to this we have had. August 9th, on the anniversary of the Quit India movement, we had a program. We had a jail bharo across the country in which more than 5 lakh farmers took part. The working class came together in that struggle. For the first time, Dalit organizations came together in that support, in support of it, and also the farmers. They speak about Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan. The, also the Jawans, the soldiers, came in solidarity with that, especially the soldiers who are fighting for the one rank, one pension. So all sections have been affected by the policies. That is why we saw in Mumbai also, on the last few days, you had dabbawalas coming forward, you had the small shopkeepers coming forward. We have had this experience in Rajasthan also. People who never used to be part of these struggles, middle class coming forward in this struggle. So that is a unique thing which we have seen. It is just because all sections have been affected by the policies of this government. Very high on propaganda, taxonomically very beautiful programs, Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bhima Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Annadata Aay Suraksha Yojana, but what counts is what happens on the ground. Are farmers benefiting? So that is something which is not happening. So farmers are coming in a big way for this protest. And for the first time, you also have a very unique kind of a solidarity coming up, where Nation for Farmers, doctors for farmers, students for farmers, teachers for farmers, lawyers for farmers, every section of society coming in solidarity, forming chapters in different states at the national level, and they themselves are taking it up. It is something which organizations like All India Kisan Sabha or ASHA and other organizations are not actually moving force behind that. It is a set of the people who are concerned of about farmers, they are coming for. So it is going to be a massive struggle that we will have. We earlier had on September 5th, for the first time, a worker peasant Sangharsh rally, Mazdoor Kisan Sangharsh rally, in which over 2 lakh farmers and workers had assembled in Delhi. Unfortunately, the government maintains a total indifference and insensitive attitude. They are not even willing to speak to the representatives of the farmers and workers. So they rely on propaganda. Let them close their eyes to the crisis. Surely these struggles are going to build an atmosphere for their defeat. And what is required is also to take forward this issue-based unity, to unite on more issues, to not remain restricted only to, let us say, this 5 years alone, it should be a vigilant body that will continue in future also to ensure there would be alternative policies that will ensure sustainable agriculture, ensure food for all. I will just conclude by saying so. Thank you.
We're at a time when we are going to, or we are marching towards setting up food factories where you will not require land and where you will not require farmers, and which the World Bank is thinking of subsidizing it. I think to talk about food systems, I think is remarkable, commendable, and I think it's a very challenging role that the Bharat Krishak Samaj has taken up. Thank you very much for doing that, sir. I'd like to start with two scenarios. In 1983 to be exact, when I was an agriculture correspondent for the Indian Express, Norman Borlaug, whenever he would travel in India, I would get a chance to travel with him. I must say, very lucky. 1983, Lech Walesa of Poland got the Nobel Prize, Peace Prize. So I asked Borlaug, I was with him, I said, what do you have to say about the Nobel for Walesa? Borlaug replied that, I'm glad you asked me this question, because the Nobel Prize Committee had set up a small team to go and find out whether Lech Walesa deserved the Nobel Prize or not. And you know, Lech Walesa was a Workers' Solidarity Movement leader in Poland at that time. He says, when I came back from that visit to Poland, he actually gave a report which said that Walesa does not deserve a Nobel Prize. And yet he got a Nobel Prize. So I asked Borlaug, I said, why did you say that he didn't deserve a Nobel Prize when he actually has got a Nobel Prize now? He says, when I went there, I realized what Mr. Walesa was doing was actually he was fighting for cheaper food for the workers. He was a Workers' Solidarity Movement leader. So when you are asking for cheaper food for the workers, you are in the bargain, forgetting what will happen to the millions of people who produce cheaper food. And Borlaug said that he realized that actually Walesa was pitting one class against the other, the workers' class against the farmers. And therefore, he didn't deserve a Nobel Peace Prize, if at all that Peace Prize is a very important thing. And that was his recommendation. Well, ladies and gentlemen, all over the world, we have been following a policy when the farmers are subsidizing the nation. And India is no exception. Why he got the Nobel Prize was simply because the dominant economic thinking is that food has to be cheap. And food has to be cheap. You are not worried about what is happening to farmers. Your only task is to confine to, we have achieved the food grain production targets and so on and so forth. You're not interested in what happens to the welfare of the farmers. You know, our obsession with the growth that we see in agriculture. I see on the television here every other day, oh, we are growing by this and we are growing by four, with somebody says three or two or whatever, and they're never talking about what happens to the farmers. That is woven in our thinking, in our mindset, and I think that's what we need to understand. A few months back, I remember a report in the New York Times, which said that in America, in the United States, one farmer, a dairy farmer, committed suicide. He was so much under stress that he first shot each of his 51 cows, and then he shot himself. It makes me wonder why in a country which has got the entire investment made in agriculture, sophisticated technology, the kind of investment that we talk about, has the entrepreneurship and so on and so forth, why are farmers dying? Why are farmers dying? The kind of recommendation we make in India are same borrowed from blindly from the Western countries. What has happened to this country? People are dying in America, people are dying in Europe, and we borrow the same kinds of approaches that we must follow in India. What a remarkable country we are. And so therefore, it is very important to sit and discuss food systems. We need to really radically overhaul the kind of a rotten and broken food system that this country has evolved. Why I'm saying this is because we are very comfortable. We are in a comfort zone, so we don't feel concerned. Move out 10 kilometers out of New Delhi and you will see a new India that you may have perhaps never seen it. Go out and see what is happening to farmers. And we somehow think, no, everything is fine because we are getting our food. And we are moving to a stage when we feel that farmer has become a burden on the nation. There was a time when farmer was somebody that we used to look up to as a nation. We are proud of farming. Today we are feeling burdened with farmers. We want to offload that burden as quickly as possible. It is part of an economic design. It's part of an economic design, and therefore I think it is very important to, unless we decipher what this economic design is, we will never be able to understand what is going wrong and what is hitting agriculture. You can look at from where your own perspectives that you come from, that's okay. But if you were to look at the holistic or the macro picture, you realize that the basic fundamental problem that agriculture suffers from, whether in United States of America or in Europe or in Japan or in India, is basically denial of his rightful income to the farmers. Farmers have been denied their rightful income all these years, let's be very clear. At least for four decades, I can vouch for it, that the price that the farmers get in 2018 is almost equal to the price he was getting in 1980 for his commodities. If you adjust for inflation, there is no difference. The prices are frozen. The incomes are frozen. I wish the income of the middle class in this country were also frozen. Then only they would have appreciated or realized how difficult it is to survive when your incomes are frozen for four decades. A recent OECD report in India has said very clearly that for the past two decades, the income of farmers has remained frozen. Earlier, I remember an UNTAD report saying that between 1985 and 2005, the global output, the global farm gate prices had remained static or frozen if you adjust for inflation, which means for the last four decades, there has been no quantum jump or no increase in the real income of farmers. And we go on telling him, giving him sermons and approaches and say, you do this, you do that. Somebody will say, you bring in precision farming. Somebody says, you go into genetically modified crop. Everybody is selling his products and that is what you want. We have reached a stage when the agriculture, improvement for agriculture means how much inputs you are able to sell. That's the entire focus. But there is agriculture without inputs also. The kind of inputs that are being sold. That's what I want to talk about. We never focus on that. Look at the stubble burning happening in Punjab. More machines. Not even knowing whether machines are the answer, but we are very happy pushing in more machines. We have subsidy for machines, but we have no subsidy to give it directly to the human beings, to the farmers. That's why the human capital index is not at all talked about in India. Because we don't want to talk about humans. We think agriculture economy, and when we talk about general economy, we believe that economic growth only means industry and infrastructure. Agriculture is never considered to be an economic activity. That has been the bane of this the agriculture for last so many decades in this country. Somehow I feel, and I realize when I look back at agriculture for four decades, I realize it is not the farmers who have failed the country. It is basically agriculture economists who have failed the farmers. They have failed the farmers. They have misled us to believe that you raise your income, you raise your productivity and productivity and productivity, your incomes will go up. They also have raised, they said that, you know, more market dependence is what is required to give you a higher price. I wish the agriculture economists of this country were to be getting out of the kind of fixed salary that they get, assured salary they get, and depend on markets. Then only they realize what it means to be on the markets. We are very happy telling farmers, you go on markets. Why, Baba, why are you not going on markets? Everyone who is on a stabilized job, assured job, his job is taken care of, is the one who advises markets for the others. I have nothing against markets, but we know the tyranny of markets everywhere in the world. Look at a country like India. We have been hearing since morning, I was hearing that, you know, MSP, MSP, MMSP, it can't be done, it can't be done. That's what we heard again and again. According to Shanta Kumar Committee, only 6% farmers get MSP in India. I haven't seen anyone talking about the 94% farmers, the remaining 94% farmers. Go to any discussion, go to any farmers' agitation, we never see anyone talking about what will happen to the 94% of the farming population, which is dependent on markets. And if markets were so efficient, I'm sure you'll agree, these farmers wouldn't have been committing suicide. There's something fundamentally going wrong. There's something fundamentally going wrong, and I think this is very timely that a dialogue on food, you know, we need to hold on food systems is becoming very crucial and timely. Why? Let's look at it now. Agriculture, as I said, has been deliberately kept impoverished. We knew it, but we have done it. Why? Because if food prices go up, we believe inflation will zoom up. And once inflation goes up, you know, the governments can also fall. So to keep inflation under control, we are passing on the burden to the farmers. He's solely being held responsible for keeping the food prices low. No, the nation has never stood up with farmers, knowing very well that he's not getting what is due to him. We are very happy with getting the kind of food that we get at cheaper prices. But look at the bigger narrative that is built. I've been asked this again and again. Why are the farmers committing suicide? Even in a bumper season, we find farmers commit suicide. When I looked into it, I realized how deliberately the incomes were denied to the farmers, his rightful income. And I gave you an example which many of you would have heard me earlier speaking. In 1970, the procurement price of wheat was 76 rupees per quintal. In 1970, the salary of a school teacher was 90 rupees per month. In 1971, when they got a jump of 10 rupees in salary, they celebrated Diwali. In 1970, the price was 76 rupees per quintal for wheat. In 2015, it goes up to 1450 rupees per quintal in a gap of 45 years. In 45 years, the farmer's income, if wheat is an indicator, if MSP is an indicator, then the income has gone up by only 19 times in 45 years. When I look at the other sections of the society, I'm surprised and shocked. You know, the salary of government employees, you know, so government employees has gone up by 120 to 150 times in the same period. The salary of school teachers has gone up by 280 to 320 times in the same period. The salary of college teachers and professors has gone up by 150 to 170 times in the same period. The salary of corporate employees has gone up by 300 to 1,000 times in the same period. And the salary or the income of the farmers has gone up by 19 times. I'm sure if the income was denied, or rightful income was denied to the other section of society, they would have also committed suicide in a very large number. But somehow we never talk about farmers. We think, oh, what will happen if the prices go up? Now, if I were to go by the minimum yardstick, let's say 100, I take as the 100 times as the what the farmer deserves or should have been given, then in those 45 years, the actual wheat price should have been 7,600 rupees per quintal. But the moment I say 7,600 rupees per quintal, everyone is up in arm. What will happen to my kitchen budget or my household budget? But what will happen to this farmer who has been denied his rightful income? Rightful income for him is 7,600 rupees per quintal. He got 1,450 as the minimum income that, you know, we call it minimum support price. I think it's much lower than even the minimum. We have denied him his rightful income. He is actually being penalized to grow food. Farmer doesn't realize that every time he takes up cultivation of crops, he actually ends up cultivating losses. The stories are ample. Everywhere you can see that. But they are being denied that. Now, can't we have a mechanism where we can provide farmers with his rightful income? We heard that MSP is not possible. We also know markets are completely inefficient. Let me make it very clear. Nowhere in the world are market efficient. This impression that has been given to us has been given to by the markets themselves, those who play in that game. Markets are never efficient. If markets were so efficient, look at the United States of America. Their chief economist of the U.S. Department of Agriculture has gone on record saying that real income in America has fallen since 1960. Where are these markets that we talk about? Even real incomes, even in the United States of America, are falling or on decline since 1960, you can imagine what is happening to agriculture all over the world. If agriculture is still there in America and Europe, it's because of the monumental subsidies they pump into agriculture. And 80% of these subsidies go to corporates. All those corporates who come and teach us about markets are efficient are the ones who are highly subsidized under the WTO regime and so on. But we never question them. 80% subsidies go to the corporates. Withdraw those subsidies, most of the corporates will collapse. The ones who are exporting all the grains to us or to the globe. But then its design is so that we don't understand. We don't even realize, oh my God, where it is hitting the farmers. Is there a way out? I think, first of all, food systems. I think I have two suggestions. One, we need to overhaul the present food system. We need to overhaul the present system. The price, the cheap price of food, I think, is not what exactly we should have been told, or we should try to go beyond that. There's definitely a need to work out the ecosystem services that farmers protect. There's a need to work out what exactly farmers need to ensure or put in or to save also the world from collapsing. We are also being told, if I have read the recent report of the economics of ecosystem services of biodiversity, and you find the T report, it is said that the greenhouse gas emissions from agriculture are 57% of the total greenhouse gas emissions. And it includes from deforestation right up to the waste. So that tells you how much is the role this entire food system has not positively but negatively created. Now, having said that, I think that's one task that we must do, ecosystem services approach, where we try to work out what exactly is the kind of effort that the farmer has put in to save that environment, and negatively or positively, and then value food accordingly. This is a task which a few of us have taken. We would be coming out with a report, hopefully in February, at a conference in Chandigarh. The other task, I think, which is also very crucial, is how to provide farmers with an assured income. We have heard about various options that are not available or which would create problems and so on and so forth. But I think some years back, when I first said that the only way forward to pull out agriculture from the crisis that it is, whether it is in India or in America or in Europe, is to provide farmers with an assured income every month. Farmers produce economic wealth for the country. Everywhere in the world, farmers produce economic wealth. But when you look at the economic map or structure, that doesn't figure in. We have never considered agriculture as an economic activity. It is high time now that we appreciate and acknowledge that the farmers are, in fact, farmer is the only section in India that has been most productive and most efficient in the last 10 years that at least I know of. Everywhere you have seen the kind of decline in industrial output, in manufacturing output, in exports, and so on and so forth, agriculture is the only sector which has grown despite the crisis. We need to acknowledge that it is agriculture which is keeping this country alive. If agriculture was to collapse, everything would have collapsed. You know, it is always said that the strength of a chain is known from the weakest link. And I think we have never looked at the weakest link that actually is the strength of this particular chain. Why I'm saying this is, how do we work out this economics, the kind of economics that the farmer deserves? We have worked on this, we've gone into it, and we've seen that a living income or a kind of a income which makes the farmer survive, he also needs 18,000 rupees per month. Unfortunately, the Economic Survey 2016 tells us that the average income of a farming family in 17 states of India is 20,000 rupees a year. Now, if this is the kind of economic level, I think it becomes very clear to all of us that the deliberate mechanism that we kept incomes or farm incomes low has really worked all these years. Then we are told that farmers are not productive. Now, this is another argument that I see very often. Come to Punjab. Those of you who say this, that you know productivity is, because Indian productivity is low, that's why the incomes are low, must come to Punjab. Punjab has 98% assured irrigation. Punjab has the highest productivity of cereal crops in the world. I am saying the highest productivity. And yet Punjab has become a hotspot of farmer suicides. In the last 17 years, between 2000 and 2017, 16,600 farmers have committed suicide. Pick up the newspaper any day and you will find 2, 3, 4 farmers dying. If in Punjab, which has 98% assured irrigation and has the highest productivity in the world, farmers are dying, there's something going wrong terribly which is not related to productivity. I'm sure you'll agree with that. And that is the denial of income. Farmers have been denied their income sooner or later. You can have all those kind of innovations, entrepreneurship that we talk about all in all seminars that I go to. But eventually it is what exactly comes into his pocket or what comes into his hand. And that is being denied. I am sure eventually all those innovations, the startups that we have, would also go the same way. We have seen in the past, it will happen in the future. Because we refuse to accept that income, denial of income is the biggest problem that agriculture faces. And this country has no shortage of money. Let's be very clear. We have given money to corporates. We have given money for the seventh pay commission. I don't know why the country needed seventh pay commission. Look at the pay commission now. You know, you 2% employees in this country, they're getting what? 4,80,000 crores every year. Credit Suisse Bank tells us that when you have to implement this seventh pay commission across the country, the total annual burden every year additional would be 4,80,000 crores. Did anybody ask you where will the money come from? Did anybody say fiscal deficit will grow up? Because everyone is happy. They are the ones who make noise and they are the ones who get the benefits. So everyone is happy. 4,80,000 crores. And if you give farmers 2,00,000 crore, announce it now, there will be hangama in this country. Where will this money come from? This money will go down the drain. A fiscal deficit badh jayega and so on and so forth. The narrative. We need to understand the vocabulary and the narrative that has been built up around us. You know, corporates have been given a tax exemption of 55,00,000 crore in the last 14 years. 55,00,000 crores could have wiped out poverty from India for 110 years. Did anybody question? There's no shortage of money. We are giving, subsidizing the corporates, and what output they have given, we all know that. There is no job creation in this country that has taken place in the last 14 years, at least we know of. 14 years is a pretty long period to understand there's something going wrong somewhere. We need to overhaul. That's what I have been focusing again. We need to overhaul the system, bring it on agriculture, because sabka saath sabka vikas can only happen if 52% of the population gets more money in their hand. Once they get more money in their hand, there will be more demand. Once there is more demand, there will be a kind of a revival of the industrial economy of this country. Isn't that the right kind of mechanism? But then we try to look at, because in our economics 101, economics 201 that we studied, it is not part of the curriculum. The economists can't even think beyond what has been taught to them in economics 201 and economics 301. That's the biggest problem. You always talk about supply demand. I was listening to somebody in the morning saying supply demand. It's not supply demand. There is something called as manipulation. We never talk about it. It is manipulation which actually works out what are the real prices and so on and so forth. Supply demand is not the factor. Let's be very clear about it. But because it is not in your textbook, you are afraid to stand up and question even the textbooks. That's the biggest tragedy of this country. Now, having said that, is there a way we can work out a kind of a income, assured income for the farmers? how much would it cost, and so on and so forth. As I told you earlier, the price that the wheat price should have been 7,600 rupees per quintal, and what he's getting is only 14-15. Why can't we have a mechanism where we can buy from the farmers the same way we procure, the same procurement system we procure from the farmers? We ensure that the remaining 6,000 rupees are transferred to his Jandhan account. Is this possible or not? It will ensure that the inflation remains under control. It will also ensure that the farmers get his due. Why can't we do that? Why can't we transfer the remaining 6,000 rupees into his account directly? It's possible. Secondly, what we need to do is set up a commission for farmers' income and welfare. We already have a commission for agriculture cost and prices. Change the name, make it commission for farmers' income and welfare. Change the mandate, make it responsible to ensure that it has to ensure that every farming family gets 18,000 rupees minimum per month. Is it possible? Let them put their heads together, let the economists come together and see whether it's possible and where do we get the resources. As I said earlier, there's no dearth of resources in this country. It's only our willingness that we do not want to actually pull out agriculture from the kind of crisis that it is faced with, because we generally believe, the understanding is, these are the abandoned people. These are the abandoned people, we have all given up hope on them. Because as the World Bank had actually told us in 1996, the task before us is to move 400 million people out of rural areas into the urban areas. That should have been done by 2015. We failed to do that, and the World Bank is now pushing us, do it aggressively, move these people out. And of course, successive governments have been very keen to bring to ensure that, because we generally believe that economic growth can only take place if you cut down on the population in agriculture, if you move population out of agriculture into urban area. There is a fallacy here. This is a flawed thinking. And I think the only way a country can grow is to make agriculture sustainable, ecologically viable, and also, of course, economically viable. It is possible to work on these lines. And I think this is the challenge of a food systems dialogue. I hope so. This is the challenge that we want to look at a world which does not end to climate aberrations, which does not spoil the soil health, which does not mine water, and which of course provides us a kind of a sustainable and healthy food. Thank you very much.
Discussion honi bahut zaruri hai, te discussion de naal clarity bhi aundi hai. Je assi gal kariye farmers de jehde ਇਸ਼ੂਜ ਹੈਗੇ ਆ ਕਿ ਜਿਹਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਕਿਸਾਨੀ ਸੰਕਟ ਹੈਗਾ ਗਾ, ਜਿਹਦੀ ਅਸੀਂ ਗੱਲ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ ਕਿ ਕਿਸਾਨ ਲਗਾਤਾਰ ਸੁਸਾਈਡ ਕਰ ਰਿਹਾ ਗਾ, ਉਹਦੇ ਇੱਕ ਨਾ ਹੀ ਤਾਂ ਕਿਸਾਨ ਕੋਲ ਕੋਈ ਇਨਕਮ ਦਾ ਸੋਰਸ ਹੈਗਾ ਗਾ, ਇਨਕਮ ਦਾ ਸੋਰਸ ਪੈਦਾ ਕਿੱਥੋਂ ਹੋਊਗਾ, ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਉਹ ਐਗਰੀਕਲਚਰ ਖੇਤੀ ਕਰ ਰਿਹਾ ਗਾ ਉਹ ਉਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਕੋਈ ਪ੍ਰੋਫਿਟ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੋ ਰਿਹਾ। ਫਾਰਮਰ ਰਿਐਲਿਟੀ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਫਾਰਮਰ ਉਹ ਹੈਗਾ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਬਿਲਕੁਲ ਖੇਤੀ 'ਤੇ ਹੀ ਡਿਪੈਂਡ ਹੈਗਾ, ਖੇਤੀ ਕਰ ਰਿਹਾ, ਉਹਨੇ ਬੱਚਿਆਂ ਦੀ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਵੀ, ਹੈਲਥ ਦੀ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਪ੍ਰੋਬਲਮ ਆ ਉਹ ਵੀ, ਜੋ ਖੇਤੀ 'ਤੇ ਉਹਦਾ ਖਰਚਾ ਆ ਰਿਹਾ ਉਹ ਵੀ, ਮਤਲਬ ਉਹਨੇ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਸਾਰਾ ਖੇਤੀ 'ਤੇ ਹੀ ਡਿਪੈਂਡ ਹੈਗਾ, ਉਹ ਅਸਲੀ ਫਾਰਮਰ ਹੈਗਾ। ਅਸੀਂ ਇੱਥੇ ਬਹੁਤ ਡਿਸਕਸ਼ਨ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂਗੇ, ਫਾਰਮਰ ਵੀ ਕਹਿ ਰਿਹਾ ਵੀ ਫਾਰਮਰ ਵੀ ਇੱਥੇ ਡਿਸਕਸ਼ਨ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹੈਗੇ। ਮੈਨੂੰ ਲੱਗਦਾ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਬਿਲਕੁਲ ਖੇਤੀ 'ਤੇ ਹੀ ਡਿਪੈਂਡ ਹੈਗਾ ਉਹ ਰਿਐਲਿਟੀ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਫਾਰਮਰ ਹੈਗਾ ਗਾ। ਫਾਰਮਰ ਦੀ ਪ੍ਰੋਬਲਮ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਜੇ ਫਾਰਮਰ ਇੱਕ ਖੇਤੀ ਸਟਾਰਟ ਕਰਦਾ ਹੈ, ਖੇਤੀ ਕਰਨੀ ਸ਼ੁਰੂ ਕਰਦਾ ਗਾ, ਉਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਪਹਿਲਾਂ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਲੋਨ ਲੈਣਾ ਪੈਂਦਾ, ਉਹਦੇ ਕੋਲ ਕੋਈ ਹੋਰ ਕੋਈ ਇਨਕਮ ਦਾ ਸੋਰਸ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈਗਾ ਗਾ, ਉਹ ਕੋਈ ਐਜੂਕੇਟਡ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈਗਾ ਇੰਨਾ ਵੀ ਕਿਤੇ ਜਾ ਕੇ ਜਿਹੜੀਆਂ ਸਾਡੀਆਂ ਪੋਲਿਸੀ ਬਣਦੀਆਂ ਨੇਗੀਆਂ ਜਾਂ ਬਣਾਈਆਂ ਜਾਂਦੀਆਂ ਨੇਗੀਆਂ ਵੀ ਉਹ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਅਕੋਰਡਿੰਗ ਖੇਤੀ ਕਰ ਸਕੇ, ਹੈ ਨਾ। ਜਦੋਂ ਕਿਸੇ ਵੀ ਉਹ ਸਰਕਾਰੀ ਜਾਂ ਗੈਰ ਸਰਕਾਰੀ ਸੰਸਥਾ ਤੋਂ ਲੋਨ ਲੈਂਦਾ ਗਾ, ਅੱਗੇ ਉਹ ਆਪਣੀ ਫਸਲ ਦੀ ਬਿਜਾਈ ਕਰਦਾ ਗਾ, ਉਹ ਕਈ ਵਾਰ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਸਾਡੇ ਸੀਡਸ ਨੇ ਜਾਂ ਹੋਰ ਆਉਂਦੀਆਂ ਸੀਡਸ ਵਗੈਰਾ ਆ ਗਈਆਂ, ਕੀਟਨਾਸ਼ਕ ਦਵਾਈਆਂ ਆ ਗਈਆਂ, ਮਤਲਬ ਕਈ ਵਾਰ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਵੀ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਬਹੁਤ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਵੀ ਮਿਲਾਵਟ ਆਉਂਦੀ ਹੈਗੀ, ਅਤੇ ਨਾਲ ਹੀ ਜਿਹੜੀਆਂ ਉਹ ਵੀ ਕੁਦਰਤੀ ਕਰੋਪੀਆਂ ਦਾ ਵੀ ਸ਼ਿਕਾਰ ਹੁੰਦਾ ਗਾ, ਜਿਹਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਉਹਦੀ ਇਨਕਮ ਦਾ ਸੋਰਸ ਆ ਬਿਲਕੁਲ ਜ਼ੀਰੋ ਲੈਵਲ ਦਾ ਹੋ ਜਾਂਦਾ ਗਾ। ਇਸ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਕਿਹਾ ਜਾਂਦਾ ਗਾ ਵੀ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਕਿਸਾਨ ਸੁਸਾਈਡ ਕਰ ਰਿਹਾ ਗਾ ਵੀ ਉਹਦੀ ਕੁਛ ਆਪਦੀ ਵੀ ਮਤਲਬ ਸਿਰਦਰਦੀ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਹੁੰਦੀ ਹੈ, ਮਤਲਬ ਉਹ ਆਪਣੀ ਲੋੜ ਤੋਂ ਖਰਚੇ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਕਰਦਾ ਗਾ, ਕਿਉਂ ਉਸਦਾ ਕੋਈ ਮਨ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੋਏਗਾ, ਉਸਦੀ ਇੱਛਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੋਏਗੀ ਕਿ ਉਸਦਾ ਬੱਚਾ ਵੀ ਇੱਕ ਵਧੀਆ ਯੂਨੀਵਰਸਿਟੀ ਕਾਲਜ ਸਕੂਲ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਪੜ੍ਹੇ, ਉਹਦਾ ਬੱਚਾ ਵੀ ਇੱਕ ਹਾਈ ਲੈਵਲ ਦੀ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਪ੍ਰਾਪਤ ਕਰੇ। ਉਹਦੀ ਵੀ ਇੱਛਾ ਇਹ ਹੁੰਦੀ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਆਪਣੇ ਬੱਚੇ ਨੂੰ ਵਧੀਆ ਯੂਨੀਵਰਸਿਟੀ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਪੜ੍ਹਾ ਸਕੇ, ਤਾਂ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਵੀ ਅੱਗੇ ਇਸ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਖੇਤੀ ਦਾ ਘਾਟੇ ਦਾ ਸੌਦਾ ਗਾ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਇਸ ਸਿਸਟਮ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਬਾਹਰ ਨਿਕਲ ਸਕੇ। ਪਰ ਪ੍ਰੋਬਲਮ ਇਹ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਨਾ ਹੀ ਤਾਂ ਉਹਦੇ ਕੋਲ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਹੈ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਉਹ ਇੰਨੀ ਮਹਿੰਗੀ ਹੋ ਚੁੱਕੀ ਹੈਗੀ ਕਿ ਨਾ ਹੀ ਤਾਂ ਉਹ ਆਪਣੇ ਬੱਚੇ ਨੂੰ ਚੰਗੀ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਦੇ ਸਕਦਾ ਗਾ, ਅਤੇ ਨਾ ਹੀ ਉਹ ਆਪਣੀਆਂ ਜਿਹੜੀਆਂ ਹੈਲਥ ਸਮੱਸਿਆਵਾਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਹੱਲ ਕਰ ਸਕਦਾ ਗਾ। ਪਹਿਲਾਂ ਦੌਰੇ ਸੀ ਕਿ ਸਾਰੇ ਵੀ ਗੌਰਮੈਂਟ ਸਕੂਲਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਪੜ੍ਹਦੇ ਸੀ, ਸਾਰਿਆਂ ਦੀ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਹੋਸਪਿਟਲ ਦਾ ਮਤਲਬ ਹੈਲਥ ਸਮੱਸਿਆ ਸੀ ਉਹ ਇੱਕੋ ਹੋਸਪਿਟਲ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਆਉਂਦੀਆਂ ਸੀ, ਪਰ ਹੁਣ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਸਾਡਾ ਸ਼ਹਿਰੂ ਅਤੇ ਪੇਂਡੂ ਗਾਇਪ ਹੈਗਾ ਉਹ ਬਹੁਤ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਵੱਧ ਗਿਆ ਹੈਗਾ, ਬਹੁਤ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਡਿਫਰੈਂਟ ਆ ਸ਼ਹਿਰੂ ਅਤੇ ਸ਼ਹਿਰੀ ਅਤੇ ਪੇਂਡੂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਆ ਗਿਆ ਹੈਗਾ। ਇਹਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਹੀ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਇੱਕ ਅਮੀਰੀ ਅਤੇ ਗਰੀਬੀ ਦਾ ਪਾੜਾ ਹੈ ਬਹੁਤ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਪੈ ਗਿਆ ਹੈਗਾ। ਅਮੀਰਾਂ ਦੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਸਕੂਲ ਯੂਨੀਵਰਸਿਟੀਆਂ ਕੋਲਜ ਨੇਗੇ ਉਹ ਅਲੱਗ ਹੋ ਚੁੱਕੇ ਹੈਗੇ, ਅਤੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਗਰੀਬ ਬੱਚੇ ਨੇਗੇ, ਗਰੀਬ ਘਰਾਂ ਦੇ ਕਿਸਾਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਬੱਚੇ ਹੈਗੇ, ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਸਕੂਲ ਯੂਨੀਵਰਸਿਟੀਆਂ ਅਲੱਗ ਹੋ ਚੁੱਕੀਆਂ ਨੇਗੀਆਂ। ਅਤੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਗੌਰਮੈਂਟ ਸਕੂਲਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਫਾਰਮਰ ਦੇ ਬੱਚੇ ਗੌਰਮੈਂਟ ਸਕੂਲਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਪੜ੍ਹ ਰਹੇ ਹੈ, ਨਾ ਹੀ ਤਾਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਉੱਦਾਂ ਦੀ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਮਿਲ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ, ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਸਾਡੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਗੌਰਮੈਂਟ ਸਕੂਲ ਨੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਕੋਈ ਵੀ ਸਟਾਫ ਉਪਲਬਧ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈਗਾ ਗਾ। ਇੱਕ ਦੋ ਟੀਚਰ ਹੋਣਗੇ ਜੋ ਮਤਲਬ ਕੋਈ ਵੀ ਉਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਸਹੂਲਤ ਨਹੀਂ ਪ੍ਰਾਪਤ ਹੋ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ, ਨਾ ਹੀ ਤਾਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਬੱਚਿਆਂ ਨੂੰ ਸਹੀ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਮਿਲ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ, ਨਾ ਹੀ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਮਤਲਬ ਫੂਡ ਦੀ ਵੀ ਬਹੁਤ ਸਮੱਸਿਆ ਆ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਆਪਣਾ ਸਹੀ ਭੋਜਨ ਖਾ ਸਕਣ, ਸੰਤੁਲਿਤ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਭੋਜਨ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਉਹ ਵੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਮਿਲ ਰਿਹਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਗਾ। ਨਾਲ ਨਾਲ ਪ੍ਰੋਬਲਮ ਇਹ ਵੀ ਹੈ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਉਹ ਫੈਮਲੀਜ਼ ਨੇ ਉਹ ਕੁਦਰਤੀ ਕਰੋਪੀਆਂ ਦਾ ਸ਼ਿਕਾਰ ਵੀ ਹੁੰਦੇ ਨੇ, ਅਤੇ ਜਿਹੜੀਆਂ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਸਾਡੀ ਰਾਜਨੀਤਿਕ ਘਟੀਆ ਨੀਤੀਆਂ ਨੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦਾ ਵੀ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਸ਼ਿਕਾਰ ਉਹ ਹੁੰਦੇ ਨੇ। ਜਿਹੜੀ ਸਾਡੀ ਰਾਜਨੀਤਿਕ ਇਹ ਪਾਰਟੀਬਾਜ਼ੀ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਪਿੰਡਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਡਿਵਾਈਡ ਕੀਤਾ ਗਿਆ ਹੈਗਾ, ਮਤਲਬ ਇੱਕ ਤਾਂ ਫਿਜ਼ੀਕਲੀ ਉਹ ਹੈਂਡੀਕੈਪਟ ਮੰਨਿਆ ਜਾਂਦਾ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਫਿਜ਼ੀਕਲੀ ਆਪਣੀ ਫਿਜ਼ੀਕਲੀ ਹੈਂਡੀਕੈਪਟ ਹੋਵੇ ਤਾਂ ਆਪਣੀ ਮਤਲਬ ਮੈਂਟਲੀ ਥਿੰਕਿੰਗ ਹੈ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਉਹ ਤਾਂ ਸੋਚ ਸਕਦਾ ਨਾ, ਮੈਂਟਲੀ ਤਾਂ ਸੋਚ ਸਕਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ, ਪਰ ਹੁਣ ਜਿਹੜੀਆਂ ਸਾਡੀਆਂ ਇਹ ਰਾਜਨੀਤਿਕ ਨੀਤੀਆਂ ਨੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਇੰਨਾ ਮੈਂਟਲੀ ਵੀ ਹੈਂਡੀਕੈਪਟ ਕਰ ਦਿੱਤਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਮਤਲਬ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਸੋਚਣ ਸ਼ਕਤੀ ਉਹ ਵੀ ਬਿਲਕੁਲ ਖਤਮ ਹੋ ਗਈ ਹੈ। ਮਤਲਬ ਉਹ ਇਹ ਸੁਬਹਾ ਤੋਂ ਕੰਮ 'ਤੇ ਜਾਂਦਾ, ਆਪਣੇ ਖੇਤ 'ਤੇ ਜਾਂਦਾ, ਸ਼ਾਮ ਨੂੰ 8-9 ਵਜੇ ਘਰ ਆਉਂਦਾ, ਸਿਰਫ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਆਪਣੀ ਰਸੋਈ ਦਾ ਆਪਣੇ ਬੱਚਿਆਂ ਦਾ ਹੀ ਫਿਕਰ ਹੈ। ਇਸ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈਗਾ ਗਾ ਕਿ ਵੀ ਮੈਂ ਕਿਤੇ ਬਾਹਰ ਜਿਹੜੀਆਂ ਕਿਸੇ ਹੋਰ ਦੀ ਮੈਂ ਜਾਂ ਕੋਈ ਨਿਊਜ਼ ਵਗੈਰਾ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਡੇਲੀ ਨਿਊਜ਼ ਪੇਪਰ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਤੋਂ ਉਹਦਾ ਬਹੁਤ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਗੈਪ ਪਿਆ ਹੋਇਆ ਗਾ। ਇਸ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਜੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਗੱਲ ਕਰਦੇ ਬੱਚਿਆਂ ਦੀ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਦੀ, ਬੱਚੇ ਫਿਰ ਹੀ ਉਹ ਫੀਲਡ ਅੱਗੇ ਆ ਸਕਦੇ ਜੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਅੱਛੀ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਮਿਲ ਸਕਦੀ ਹੈਗੀ। ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਇੰਨੀ ਮਹਿੰਗੀ ਹੋ ਗਈ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਉਹ ਮਿਲ ਨਹੀਂ ਰਹੀ। ਅਤੇ ਇਸ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਜੇ ਹੈਲਥ ਦੀ ਗੱਲ ਕਰਦੇ ਹਾਂਗੇ, ਜੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਸਰਕਾਰੀ ਹੋਸਪਿਟਲ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਜਾਂਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਤਾਂ ਉੱਥੇ ਕੋਈ ਡਾਕਟਰ ਨਹੀਂ ਮਿਲਦਾ। ਜਿਹੜੀਆਂ ਪਿੰਡਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਛੋਟੀਆਂ ਡਿਸਪੈਂਸਰੀਆਂ ਨੇ ਜਿੱਥੋਂ ਆਪਣਾ ਇਲਾਜ ਕਰਵਾ ਸਕਦਾ, ਉੱਥੇ ਕੋਈ ਡਾਕਟਰ ਨਹੀਂ, ਉਹ ਬਿਲਕੁਲ ਬੰਦ ਹੋ ਚੁੱਕੀਆਂ ਨੇਗੀਆਂ। ਅਤੇ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਸਾਡਾ ਅਮੀਰੀ ਅਤੇ ਗਰੀਬੀ ਦਾ ਪਾੜਾ ਉਹ ਤਾਂ ਆਲਰੇਡੀ ਬਹੁਤ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਹੀ ਵੱਧ ਚੁੱਕਿਆ ਗਾ। ਅਤੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਪਿੰਡਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਪਾਟੋ ਧਾੜ ਦਾ ਕੰਮ ਹੈ, ਜਿਹੜਾ ਆਪਸੀ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਸਾਂਝ ਸੀ, ਆਪਸੀ ਤਾਲਮੇਲ ਸੀ, ਜਿੱਥੇ ਇਹ ਆਪਣੇ ਗੱਲ ਕਹਿ ਵੀ ਸਕਦੇ ਸੀ ਅਤੇ ਸੁਣ ਵੀ ਸਕਦੇ ਸੀ, ਉਹ ਬਿਲਕੁਲ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਸਾਡੀ ਸੁਸਾਇਟੀ ਹੈ ਬਿਲਕੁਲ ਟੁੱਟ ਚੁੱਕੀ ਹੈਗੀ। ਅਤੇ ਇਹਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਹੀ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਲੱਗਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਵੀ ਜੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਜਿੱਦਾਂ ਅਸੀਂ ਅੱਜ ਇੱਥੇ ਪੋਲਸੀ 'ਤੇ ਡਿਸਕਸ਼ਨ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹੈਗੇ, ਪੋਲਸੀ 'ਤੇ ਡਿਸਕਸ਼ਨ ਹੋ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ, ਪੋਲਸੀਆਂ ਇੱਥੋਂ ਹੀ ਬਣਦੀਆਂ ਨੇ, ਅਤੇ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਲੱਗਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਵੀ ਜੇ ਪੋਲਸੀਆਂ ਇੱਥੇ ਬਣਦੀਆਂ ਨੇ ਅਤੇ ਇੱਥੇ ਹੀ ਰਹਿ ਜਾਂਦੀਆਂ, ਉਹ ਫਾਰਮਰ ਤੱਕ ਕਦੇ ਨਹੀਂ ਪਹੁੰਚਦੀਆਂ। ਜੇ ਪਹੁੰਚਦੀਆਂ ਵੀ ਨੇ ਤਾਂ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਨਹੀਂ ਲੱਗਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਕਿ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਪੋਲਸੀਆਂ ਦੀ ਸਮਝ ਹੋਏਗੀ। ਮੈਂ ਕਦੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਦੇਖਿਆ ਹੈਗਾ ਵੀ ਅੱਜ ਐਗਰੀਕਲਚਰ ਡਿਪਾਰਟਮੈਂਟ ਵੱਲੋਂ ਪਿੰਡਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਕੈਂਪ ਲਗਾਏ ਜਾ ਰਹੇ ਆ ਜਾਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਟ੍ਰੇਨਿੰਗ ਦਿੱਤੀ ਜਾ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ। ਮੈਂ ਇੱਕ ਫਾਰਮਰ ਦੀ ਬੇਟੀ ਹਾਂ, ਮੇਰੇ ਫਾਦਰ 2-2.5 ਸਾਲ ਪਹਿਲੇ ਸੁਸਾਈਡ ਕਰ ਗਏ, ਉਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਵੀ ਬਹੁਤ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਪ੍ਰੋਬਲਮਸ ਆਈਆਂ, ਹੈ ਨਾ। ਕਦੇ ਮੈਂ ਇਹ ਨਹੀਂ ਦੇਖਿਆ ਹੈਗਾ ਵੀ ਅੱਜ ਕਿਸੇ ਐਗਰੀਕਲਚਰ ਡਿਪਾਰਟਮੈਂਟ ਦੇ ਜਾਂ ਕੋਈ ਚੇਅਰਮੈਨ ਜਾਂ ਚੀਫ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਅੱਜ ਇੱਥੇ ਪੋਲਸੀ 'ਤੇ ਡਿਸਕਸ਼ਨ ਹੋ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ ਵੀ ਇਹ ਕਿਤੇ ਪਿੰਡਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਉਹ ਫਾਰਮਰਸ ਵੀ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਰਿਅਲਟੀ ਖੇਤੀ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਆ, ਖੇਤੀ ਨਾਲ ਜੁੜੇ ਹੋਏ ਆ, ਵੀ ਅੱਜ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਵੀ ਵਿੱਚ ਲੈ ਕੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਵੀ ਗੱਲ ਸੁਣੀ ਜਾਵੇ। ਇੱਥੇ ਕੋਈ ਉਹ ਫਾਰਮਰ ਹੋਏਗਾ ਨਹੀਂ, ਇੱਥੇ ਸਿਰਫ ਅਸੀਂ ਉਹੀ ਐਜੂਕੇਟਡ ਲੋਕ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਕਿਤਾਬਾਂ ਪੜ੍ਹਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਇੱਥੇ ਬੋਲਦੇ ਹਾਂ, ਪੋਲਸੀ ਬਣਾਉਂਦੇ ਹਾਂ, ਅਤੇ ਇਹ ਪੋਲਸੀ ਸਿਰਫ ਸਾਡੇ ਤੱਕ ਹੀ ਸੀਮਤ ਰਹਿ ਜਾਂਦੀ ਹੈ। ਤੁਸੀਂ ਇਹ ਦੇਖ, ਇੱਕ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਸੁਸਾਈਡ ਵਿਕਟਮ ਫੈਮਲੀਜ਼ ਦੀ ਰਿਲੀਫ ਪੋਲਸੀ ਬਣੀ ਹੈ, ਅੱਜ ਤੱਕ ਦੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਯੂਨੀਵਰਸਿਟੀਆਂ ਨੇ ਸਾਡੀਆਂ ਨੇ ਸਰਵੇ ਕੀਤੇ ਹੈ, 16,606 ਯੂਨੀਵਰਸਿਟੀਆਂ ਦੇ ਅਕੋਰਡਿੰਗ ਕਿਸਾਨ ਖੁਦਕੁਸ਼ੀ ਕਰ ਚੁੱਕੇ ਹੈ, ਜਿਨ੍ਹਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ 5200 ਪਰਿਵਾਰਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਰਿਲੀਫ ਮਿਲੀ ਹੈ, ਜਿਹੜਾ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਮੁਆਵਜ਼ਾ ਦੇਣਾ ਉਹ ਮਿਲਿਆ। ਮੈਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਜਦੋਂ ਉਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਪੋਲਸੀ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ 3 ਮਹੀਨਿਆਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ 3 ਮੰਥ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਐਪਲੀਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਦੇਣੀ ਜ਼ਰੂਰੀ ਹੁੰਦੀ ਹੈ, ਜਦੋਂ ਕਿਸੇ ਪਰਿਵਾਰ ਦਾ ਮੁਖੀ ਮੈਂਬਰ ਸੁਸਾਈਡ ਕਰ ਜਾਂਦਾ ਤਾਂ ਇਹ ਦੇਖੋ ਵੀ ਉਸ ਪਰਿਵਾਰ ਦੀ ਕਿੰਨੀ ਕੁ ਸਮਰੱਥਾ ਹੋਏਗੀ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਕਿੰਨੀ ਕੁ ਆਪਣੇ ਆਪ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਹੌਸਲੇ 'ਚ ਹੋਏਗਾ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਐਪਲੀਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਅੱਗੇ ਦੇ ਸਕੇ ਵੀ ਮੇਰੀ ਹੈਲਪ ਕਰੋ, ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਉਹ ਤਾਂ ਉਸ ਰੂਪ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਹਲੇ ਉੱਭਰ ਕੇ ਬਾਹਰ ਵੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਆਇਆ। ਜੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਇੰਨੀ ਨੌਲੇਜ ਤਾਂ ਸਾਡੇ ਪ੍ਰਸ਼ਾਸਨ ਨੂੰ ਵੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈ, ਪਿੱਛੇ ਜੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਇੱਕ ਮਾਨਸਾ ਜ਼ਿਲ੍ਹੇ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਜਦੋਂ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਪ੍ਰੋਬਲਮ ਆਈ ਮੈਂ ਹੌਲੀ ਹੌਲੀ ਇੱਕ ਸਾਲ ਦੇ ਬਾਅਦ ਮਤਲਬ ਉਹ ਪਰਿਵਾਰਾਂ ਨਾਲ ਤਾਲਮੇਲ ਕਰਨਾ ਸ਼ੁਰੂ ਕੀਤਾ, ਮੈਂ ਗੱਲਬਾਤ ਕਰਨੀ ਸ਼ੁਰੂ ਕੀਤੀ। ਫਿਰ ਅਸੀਂ ਇੱਕ ਮੇਰਾ ਮਾਨਸਾ ਜ਼ਿਲ੍ਹੇ ਤੋਂ ਮੈਂ ਬਿਲੋਂਗ ਕਰਦੀ ਹਾਂ, ਮਾਨਸਾ ਜ਼ਿਲ੍ਹੇ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਅਸੀਂ ਜਿਹੜੇ 406 ਪਰਿਵਾਰਾਂ ਦਾ ਮਤਲਬ ਮੈਂ ਲੇਡੀਜ਼ ਇਕੱਠੀਆਂ ਹੋਈਆਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਇਕੱਠ ਰੱਖਿਆ। ਉੱਥੇ ਪ੍ਰਸ਼ਾਸਨ ਵੀ ਸੀ, ਹੋਰ ਵੱਖ ਵੱਖ ਪਾਰਟੀਆਂ ਦੇ ਵੀ ਮੈਂਬਰ ਸੀਗੇ। ਉਹ ਬੀਬੀਆਂ ਆਪਣੀ ਮਤਲਬ ਜਿਹੜੀਆਂ ਉਹ ਲੇਡੀਜ਼ ਨੇ ਆਪਣੀ ਗੱਲ ਕਹਿ ਰਹੀਆਂ ਨੇ, ਆਪਣੀ ਤਕਲੀਫ ਦੱਸ ਰਹੀਆਂ ਨੇ। ਜਦੋਂ ਅਸੀਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਉਸ ਮੰਚ ਤੱਕ ਲੈ ਕੇ ਆਉਂਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਤਾਂ ਸ਼ਾਇਦ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਲੱਗਦਾ ਕਿ ਵੀ ਹਾਂ ਅੱਜ ਸਾਡੀ ਕੋਈ ਸੁਣ ਰਿਹਾ। ਉੱਥੋਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਉਮੀਦ ਨਹੀਂ ਵੀ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਅੱਜ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਸਾਡੇ 'ਤੇ ਕਰਜ਼ਾ ਹੈ ਜੋ ਪ੍ਰੋਬਲਮ ਉਹ ਸਾਰੀਆਂ 'ਤੇ ਹੱਲ ਹੋ ਜਾਣਗੀਆਂ, ਉਹ ਸਿਰਫ ਆਪਣੀ ਗੱਲ ਕਹਿ ਰਹੀਆਂ ਨੇ। ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਮਤਲਬ ਉੱਥੇ ਹੀ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਇੰਨਾ ਕੁ ਮਤਲਬ ਉਮੀਦ, ਇੰਨੀ ਕੁ ਉਹਨਾਂ 'ਚ ਹੌਂਸਲਾ, ਇੰਨਾ ਕੁ ਕੌਨਫੀਡੈਂਸ ਪੈਦਾ ਹੁੰਦਾ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਅੱਜ ਅਸੀਂ ਆਪਣੀ ਗੱਲ ਕਹਿ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ, ਹੈ ਨਾ। ਅਤੇ ਇਸ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਉਹੀ ਮਾਨਸਾ ਦੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਵੱਖ ਵੱਖ ਇੱਦਾਂ ਦੀ ਪ੍ਰੋਗਰਾਮ 7 ਜ਼ਿਲ੍ਹਿਆਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਕੀਤੇ ਆ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਇਹ ਸੁਸਾਈਡ ਤੋਂ ਖੁਦਕੁਸ਼ੀਆਂ ਤੋਂ ਪ੍ਰਭਾਵਿਤ ਹੈਗੇ। ਉਹਦੇ ਨਾਲ 7 ਜ਼ਿਲ੍ਹਿਆਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਚੰਡੀਗੜ੍ਹ ਵੀ ਕਿਸਾਨ ਭਵਨ ਸੈਮੀਨਾਰ ਹੋਇਆ। ਉਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਇਸ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਮਾਨਸਾ ਜ਼ਿਲ੍ਹੇ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਫਿਰ ਬਾਅਦ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਅਸੀਂ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਮਹਾਤਮਾ ਗਾਂਧੀ ਸਰਬੱਤ ਵਿਕਾਸ ਯੋਜਨਾ ਤਹਿਤ 14 ਸਕੀਮਾਂ ਦਾ ਮਤਲਬ ਪਰਿਵਾਰਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਰਿਲੀਫ ਮਿਲਣੀ ਆ ਉਹ ਫਾਰਮ ਭਰੇ ਗਏ। ਉਹੀ 300 ਦੇ ਅਕੋਰਡਿੰਗ ਉਹ ਫਾਰਮ ਫਿਲ ਕਰਕੇ DC ਨੂੰ ਦਿੱਤੇ ਜਾ ਰਹੇ ਆ, ਜ਼ਿਲ੍ਹਾ ਅਧਿਕਾਰੀ। ਪਬਲਿਕ ਦੇ ਲਈ ਪਬਲਿਕ ਦੀ ਬਿਲਡਿੰਗ ਹੈ, ਜਦੋਂ ਉਹ 200-300 ਲੇਡੀ ਚੱਲ ਕੇ ਉੱਥੇ ਜਾਂਦੀ ਹੈ ਤਾਂ ਉੱਥੋਂ ਪ੍ਰਸ਼ਾਸਨ ਅੱਗੇ ਦਰਵਾਜ਼ੇ ਬੰਦ ਕਰ ਦਿੰਦੇ ਆ ਇਮੀਡੀਏਟ। ਸਾਨੂੰ ਇੰਨਾ ਕੁ ਸਾਡਾ ਰਾਈਟ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈ, ਸਾਨੂੰ ਇੰਨੀ ਕੁ ਵੀ ਫਰੀਡਮ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਪਬਲਿਕ ਦੀ ਬਿਲਡਿੰਗ ਹੈ, ਪਬਲਿਕ ਦੇ ਲਈ ਕੰਮ ਦੇ ਲਈ ਬੈਠਿਆ ਹੈ, ਪਬਲਿਕ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਟੈਕਸ ਦਿੰਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਜਾਂ ਸਾਡੀ ਉਹ ਹੈ ਉਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਤਨਖਾਹਾਂ ਲੈ ਰਹੇ ਆ, ਅਤੇ ਉਹ ਪਬਲਿਕ ਆਪਣੀ ਜਾ ਕੇ ਉੱਥੇ ਗੱਲ ਵੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਕਹਿ ਸਕਦੀ। ਉੱਥੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਉਸ ਨਾਲ DC ਸਾਹਿਬ ਨਾਲ ਗੱਲ ਕੀਤੀ ਹੈ। ਜਦੋਂ ਅਸੀਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਕਿਹਾ ਵੀ ਆਹ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਸੁਸਾਈਡ ਵਿਕਟਮ ਫੈਮਿਲੀਜ਼ ਨੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਰਿਲੀਫ ਲਈ, ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਰਾਹਤ ਦੇ ਲਈ ਆਹ ਮੁਆਵਜ਼ਾ ਲਓ, ਅਤੇ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਪਰਿਵਾਰਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਕੋਈ ਇੰਨਾ ਮਤਲਬ ਨੌਲੇਜ ਨਹੀਂ ਸੀ, ਬਿਲਕੁਲ ਅਨਪੜ੍ਹ ਫੈਮਿਲੀਆਂ ਨੇ, ਕੋਈ ਇਹ ਐਜੂਕੇਟਡ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈਗੀਆਂ ਵੀ ਇਹ 3 ਮਹੀਨਿਆਂ ਦੇ ਅੰਦਰ ਇਹ ਐਪਲੀਕੇਸ਼ਨਾਂ ਨਹੀਂ ਲਾ ਸਕੀਆਂ, ਅਤੇ ਵੀ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਆਪਣੀ ਤਰਫੋਂ ਇੱਕ ਵਾਰ ਅਸੀਂ ਤੁਹਾਨੂੰ ਦੇ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ। ਜਦੋਂ ਅਸੀਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਦਿੱਤੀ ਅਤੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਕਿਹਾ, ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਇੱਕ ਫਾਈਲ ਦੇਖੀ, ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਮੈਡਮ ਇਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਇਹ 2015 ਦੀ ਹੈ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਰਿਲੀਫ ਪੋਲਿਸੀ ਬਣੀ ਹੈ, 2016 ਦੀ ਬਣੀ ਹੈ। ਮੈਨੂੰ ਉੱਥੇ ਇੰਨਾ ਘਟੀਆ ਮਹਿਸੂਸ ਹੋਇਆ, ਜਿਹੜਾ ਸਾਡਾ ਜ਼ਿਲ੍ਹਾ ਅਧਿਕਾਰੀ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਨਹੀਂ ਪਤਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਕਿ ਵੀ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਰਿਲੀਫ ਪੋਲਿਸੀ ਆ ਉਹ ਜੂਨ 2015 ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਬਣੀ, ਉਹਨੂੰ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਖੁਦ ਨੂੰ ਦੱਸਣਾ ਪੈ ਰਿਹਾ। ਉੱਥੇ ਫਿਰ ਉਹ ਆਪਣੀ ਇਹ ਨਹੀਂ ਮੰਨ ਰਿਹਾ ਕਿ ਮੈਂ ਹਾਂ ਚਲੋ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਨਹੀਂ ਪਤਾ ਹੋਏਗਾ, ਉਹ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਇਹ ਬਹਿਸ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਮੇਰੇ ਆਫਿਸ 'ਚੋਂ ਬਾਹਰ ਚੱਲ ਜਾਓ। ਐਡਾ ਘਟੀਆ ਪ੍ਰਸ਼ਾਸਨ, ਮਤਲਬ ਇਹ ਵੀ ਮੈਂ ਇਹੀ ਕਹਿਣਾ ਚਾਹੁੰਦੀ ਵੀ ਪੋਲਿਸੀਆਂ ਬਣਦੀਆਂ, ਹੁਣ ਤੱਕ ਇਹ ਪੋਲਿਸੀ ਇਹ ਵੀ ਇੰਗਲਿਸ਼ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਸੀ, ਚਲੋ ਕਹਿਣ ਦੇ ਬਾਵਜੂਦ ਥੋੜ੍ਹਾ ਬਹੁਤ ਇਸ਼ੂ ਉੱਠਿਆ ਹੋਣਾ ਪੰਜਾਬੀ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਕੀਤੀ ਗਈ ਹੋਣੀ ਹੈ, ਮੈਂ ਚਲੋ ਮੈਂ ਨਹੀਂ ਦੇਖੀ। ਜਿਹੜੇ ਇਹ ਪੋਲਿਸੀ ਉਹ ਬਣਦੀ ਹੈ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਜਿਸ ਫਾਰਮਰ 'ਤੇ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਡਿਸਕਸ਼ਨ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ ਆਪਾਂ, ਉਸ ਫਾਰਮਰ ਨੂੰ ਵਿੱਚ ਰੱਖ ਕੇ ਕੀਤੀਆਂ ਜਾਣ, ਅਤੇ ਸ਼ਾਇਦ ਇਹ ਉੱਥੇ ਗਰਾਊਂਡ ਲੈਵਲ 'ਤੇ ਕੀਤੀਆਂ ਜਾਣ। ਜੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਅੱਜ ਕਹਾਂਗੇ ਇੱਕ ਫਾਰਮਰ ਇੱਥੇ ਹੋਏ, ਉਹਦੀ ਇੰਨੀ ਕੋਈ ਉਹਦੇ ਕੋਲ ਕੋਈ ਸੋਰਸ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਇੱਥੋਂ ਤੱਕ ਆ ਸਕੇ, ਉਹਦੇ ਕੋਲ ਕੋਈ ਇੰਨੀ ਇਨਕਮ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈ, ਅਤੇ ਫਿਰ ਕਿਉਂ ਨਹੀਂ ਜਦੋਂ ਅਸੀਂ ਅੱਜ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਹੱਕ ਬਾਰੇ, ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਰਾਈਟ ਬਾਰੇ ਗੱਲ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ, ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਕਿਉਂ ਨਹੀਂ ਉਸ ਬਾਰੇ ਨੌਲੇਜ ਹੋਣੀ ਚਾਹੀਦੀ? ਸਾਡੀ ਸਭ ਤੋਂ ਵੱਡੀ ਪ੍ਰੋਬਲਮ ਇਹੀ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਅਸੀਂ ਜਿਸ ਬਾਰੇ ਗੱਲ ਕਰਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਉਹ ਗੱਲ ਉਸ ਤੱਕ ਪਹੁੰਚਦੀ ਨਹੀਂ। ਇੱਥੇ ਦਿੱਲੀ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਹੀ ਬਣਦੀਆਂ ਨੇ, ਇਹ ਨੈੱਟ 'ਤੇ ਉਹ ਕੀਤੀਆਂ ਜਾਂਦੀਆਂ ਨੇ, ਉਹਨਾਂ ਕੋਲ ਤਾਂ ਇਮੀਡੀਏਟਲੀ ਇੱਕ ਸਿੰਪਲ ਫੋਨ ਵੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੋਏਗਾ। ਜਾਂ ਫਿਰ ਆਪਾਂ ਇਹ ਕਰ ਲਓ ਵੀ ਵੱਖ ਵੱਖ ਜਗ੍ਹਾ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਐਗਰੀਕਲਚਰ ਡਿਪਾਰਟਮੈਂਟ ਟ੍ਰੇਨਿੰਗ ਦੇ ਦਿਓ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਵੀ ਤੁਹਾਡੇ ਲਈ ਆਹ ਪੋਲਿਸੀ ਬਣੀ ਹੈ ਅਤੇ ਇਹਦੇ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਇੱਦਾਂ ਕਰ ਸਕਦੇ ਹੋ, ਤੁਹਾਨੂੰ ਆਹ ਸਬਸਿਡੀ ਮਿਲ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ। ਇਹ ਤਾਂ ਕਦੀ ਮੈਂ ਤਾਂ ਦੇਖਿਆ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈਗਾ। ਮੈਂ ਹਰ ਰੋਜ਼, ਮੇਰਾ ਬ੍ਰਦਰ ਹੈ ਹੁਣ ਮੇਰੇ ਤੋਂ ਛੋਟਾ, ਉਹ ਖੇਤੀ ਕਰ ਰਿਹਾ, ਮੈਂ ਕਦੀ ਇਹ ਨਹੀਂ ਦੇਖਿਆ ਹੈਗਾ ਕਿ ਵੀ ਹਾਂ ਅੱਜ ਉਹ ਜਿੱਦਾਂ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਆਪਣੇ ਪੋਲਿਸੀ ਦੇ ਅਕੋਰਡਿੰਗ ਕਿਹਾ ਜਾਂਦਾ ਇਹ ਇੱਦਾਂ ਹੋ ਜਾਣਾ ਚਾਹੀਦਾ, ਇਹ ਇੱਦਾਂ ਹੋਣਾ ਚਾਹੀਦਾ, ਸਿੰਚਾਈ ਇੱਦਾਂ ਹੋਣੀ ਚਾਹੀਦੀ ਆ। ਇਹ ਸਿਰਫ ਕਾਗਜ਼ੀ ਗੱਲਾਂ ਨੇ, ਜੇ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਗਰਾਊਂਡ ਲੈਵਲ 'ਤੇ ਜਾ ਕੇ ਇਹ ਕਰਾਂਗੇ ਆਪਾਂ ਤਾਂ ਸ਼ਾਇਦ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਕੋਈ ਸਮੱਸਿਆ ਦਾ ਹੱਲ ਹੋ ਸਕਦਾ। ਜੇ ਆਪਾਂ ਇੱਥੇ ਇੱਕੋ ਜਗ੍ਹਾ ਉਹੀ ਉਹ ਗਰੁੱਪ ਵਾਰ ਵਾਰ ਉਹੀ ਡਿਸਕਸ਼ਨ ਕਰਦਾ ਰਹੂਗਾ, ਮੈਨੂੰ ਨਹੀਂ ਲੱਗਦਾ ਕੋਈ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਇਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਬੈਨੀਫਿਟ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਮਿਲੇਗਾ। ਇਹਦੇ ਬਾਅਦ ਨਾਲ ਜੋ ਵੀ ਅਸੀਂ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਲੱਗਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਵੀ ਜੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਗੱਲ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਲੈਵਲ 'ਤੇ ਉੱਥੇ ਗਰਾਊਂਡ 'ਤੇ ਜਾ ਕੇ ਸੁਣਾਂਗੇ ਤਾਂ ਇਸ ਤੋਂ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਬੈਟਰ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਸਮਝ ਵੀ ਆਏਗੀ, ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਅੱਛਾ ਕਰ ਵੀ ਸਕਦੇ ਹਾਂ। ਅਤੇ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਅਸੀਂ ਗੱਲ ਕਰਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਵਾਰ ਵਾਰ ਅਤੇ ਬੱਚਿਆਂ ਦੀ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ, ਬੱਚਿਆਂ ਦੀ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਲੱਗਦਾ ਕਿ ਵੀ ਜੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਪਰਿਵਾਰਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਬੱਚਿਆਂ ਦੀ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਫਰੀ ਕੀਤੀ ਜਾਵੇ ਜਿਹੜੀਆਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਹੈਲਥ ਪ੍ਰੋਬਲਮਸ ਆ ਰਹੀਆਂ ਨੇਗੀਆਂ, ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਅੱਜ ਪ੍ਰਾਈਵੇਟ ਸਿਸਟਮ ਹੈਗਾ ਗਾ ਬਹੁਤ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਮਹਿੰਗਾ ਹੋ ਚੁੱਕਿਆ ਹੈਗਾ, ਉਹਨਾਂ ਕੋਲ ਇੰਨੀ ਕੁ ਵੀ ਕੋਈ ਇਨਕਮ ਦਾ ਸੋਰਸ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈਗਾ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਤੁਰੰਤ ਜਾ ਕੇ ਆਪਣਾ ਇਲਾਜ ਕਰਵਾ ਸਕਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ। ਜਾਂ ਇਸ ਤੋਂ ਮੈਂ ਬਹੁਤ ਵਾਰ ਇਹ ਚੀਜ਼ਾਂ ਦੇਖੀਆਂ ਨੇਗੀਆਂ, ਜਿਹੜਾ ਕੋਈ ਸਾਡੇ ਪਿੰਡਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਵਧੀਆ ਐਜੂਕੇਟਡ ਪਰਸਨ ਹੈ ਉਹ ਸ਼ਹਿਰ ਵੱਲ ਵੱਧਦਾ, ਜਦੋਂ ਸ਼ਹਿਰ ਵੱਲ ਵੱਧਦਾ ਅਤੇ ਉਹ ਫਿਰ ਉਹ ਪਿੰਡਾਂ ਨਾਲ ਉਹਦਾ ਰਾਬਤਾ ਟੁੱਟ ਜਾਂਦਾ। ਜਦੋਂ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਉਸ ਪਿੰਡ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਪੜ੍ਹ ਕੇ ਜਾਂਦੇ ਹੋ, ਉਸ ਪਿੰਡ ਦੀ ਸ਼ਹਿਰ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਆ ਕੇ ਉਸੇ ਪਿੰਡ ਦੀ ਗੱਲ ਕਰਦੇ ਹਾਂ, ਫਿਰ ਉਸ ਪਿੰਡ ਨਾਲ ਰਾਬਤਾ ਰੱਖਣਾ ਜ਼ਰੂਰੀ ਹੈ ਜਾਂ ਸ਼ਹਿਰ ਨਾਲ? ਜਿਹੜੇ ਸਾਡੀ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਹੈਗੀ ਐਡਾ ਘਟੀਆ ਸਿਸਟਮ ਹੋ ਚੁੱਕਿਆ ਹੈਗਾ ਕਿ ਸਿਰਫ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਹਾਈ ਫਾਈ ਲੋਕ ਹੈਗੇ ਉਹੀ ਚੰਗੀ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਪ੍ਰਾਪਤ ਕਰ ਸਕਦੇ ਹੈਗੇ, ਜਿਹੜਾ ਪੇਂਡੂ ਵਰਗ ਹੈਗਾ, ਕਿਸਾਨੀ ਵਰਗ ਹੈਗਾ, ਮਜ਼ਦੂਰ ਵਰਗ ਹੈਗਾ, ਉਹ ਸਿਰਫ ਉਸੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਗੌਰਮੈਂਟ ਸਕੂਲ ਨੇਗੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਘਟੀਆ ਸਿਸਟਮ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਓਨੀ ਕੁ ਹੀ ਨੌਲੇਜ ਪ੍ਰਾਪਤ ਕਰ ਸਕਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਅਤੇ ਜਿਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਉਹ ਕਦੇ ਵੀ ਇੱਥੋਂ ਤੱਕ ਪਹੁੰਚ ਨਹੀਂ ਸਕਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਆਪਣੀ ਗੱਲ ਇੱਥੋਂ ਤੱਕ ਕਹਿ ਸਕੇ। ਅਤੇ ਇਹਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਹੀ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਲੱਗਦਾ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਗੌਰਮੈਂਟ ਸਕੂਲਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਜੇ ਆਪਾਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦਾ ਸਿਸਟਮ ਵਧੀਆ ਕਰਨਾ ਚਾਹੁੰਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਵੀ ਸਾਰੇ ਬੱਚਿਆਂ ਨੂੰ ਐਜੂਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਵਧੀਆ ਪ੍ਰਾਪਤ ਹੋ ਸਕੇ, ਉਹਦੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਸਾਡੇ ਗੌਰਮੈਂਟ ਮਤਲਬ ਪਰਸਨ ਗੌਰਮੈਂਟ ਜੋਬ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਆ, ਜੇ ਸਾਡਾ ਅੱਜ ਗੌਰਮੈਂਟ ਸਿਸਟਮ ਹੈਗਾ, ਲੀਡਰਸ਼ਿਪ ਹੈ, ਜੇ ਸਾਰਿਆਂ ਦੇ ਬੱਚੇ ਇੱਕੋ ਸਕੂਲ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਪੜ੍ਹਦੇ ਹੈ ਤਾਂ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਲੱਗਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਵੀ ਸਿਰ ਸ਼ਾਇਦ ਸਾਰਿਆਂ ਨੂੰ ਟੈਨਸ਼ਨ ਹੋਵੇਗੀ ਮੇਰੇ ਬੱਚੇ ਨੇ ਇਸ ਸਕੂਲ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਪੜ੍ਹਨਾ ਹੈ ਤਾਂ ਇਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਆਹ ਸਹੂਲਤਾਂ ਹੋਣ, ਸਾਰਾ ਇੱਥੇ ਸਟਾਫ ਹੋਵੇ, ਮੈਂ ਇਸੇ ਹਸਪਤਾਲ ਤੋਂ ਇਸੇ ਹੋਸਪਿਟਲ ਤੋਂ ਇਲਾਜ ਕਰਵਾਉਣਾ ਤਾਂ ਇੱਥੇ ਉਹ ਚੀਜ਼ਾਂ ਉਪਲਬਧ ਹੋਣ ਜਿਹੜੀਆਂ ਪ੍ਰਾਈਵੇਟ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਨੇ, ਸ਼ਾਇਦ ਉਸ ਕਿਸਾਨ ਦੀ ਵੀ ਸਮੱਸਿਆ ਦਾ ਹੱਲ ਹੋ ਜੇ। ਪਰ ਨਹੀਂ, ਹੁਣ ਤਾਂ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਅਲੱਗ ਡਿਵਾਈਡ ਕਰ ਲਿਆ ਹੈ, ਅਮੀਰ ਦਾ ਅਲੱਗ ਹੋ ਗਿਆ, ਗਰੀਬ ਦਾ ਅਲੱਗ ਹੋ ਗਿਆ। ਜਦੋਂ ਅਸੀਂ ਕਿਸੇ ਗਰੀਬ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਵਿਕਟਮ ਫੈਮਿਲੀਜ਼ ਨੂੰ ਮਿਲਦੇ ਹਾਂ, ਉਹ ਆਪਣੀ ਈਵਨ ਇੰਨੀ ਚੰਗੇ ਤਰੀਕੇ ਨਾਲ ਗੱਲ ਤਾਂ ਨਹੀਂ ਕਹਿ ਸਕਦੀਆਂ, ਪਰ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਉਨੀ ਕੁ ਗੱਲ ਜਦੋਂ ਕਹਿੰਦੀਆਂ ਨੇ ਤਾਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਇੰਨੀ ਰਿਲੀਫ ਮਿਲਦੀ ਹੈ ਅਤੇ ਸ਼ਾਇਦ ਵੀ ਉਹ ਕਦੇ ਵੀ ਇਹ ਨਹੀਂ ਫਿਰ ਸੋਚਦੀਆਂ ਹੈਗੀਆਂ ਗੀਆਂ ਵੀ ਹੁਣ ਅਸੀਂ ਘੱਟ ਹੈ ਅਤੇ ਆਪਣੇ ਉਹ ਹੱਕ ਦੇ ਲੜ ਆਪਣੇ ਰਾਈਟ ਦੇ ਲਈ ਲੜਨ ਦੇ ਲਈ ਸਟਰਗਲ ਕਰਦੀਆਂ ਨੇ। ਇਸ ਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਹੀ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਲੱਗਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਵੀ ਜੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਇਸ ਤੋਂ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਬੈਟਰ ਡਿਸਕਸ਼ਨ ਅਸੀਂ ਉਸ ਫਾਰਮਰ ਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਕਰੀਏ ਤਾਂ ਇਸ ਤੋਂ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਬੈਟਰ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਕੋਈ ਇਹਦੇ ਰਿਜ਼ਲਟ ਮਿਲ ਸਕਦੇ ਹੈ। ਥੈਂਕ ਯੂ ਸੋ ਮਚ।
Thank you to the organizers for this opportunity of having these dialogues. Clearly, we are all having different perches from where we're watching the picture of what we think constitutes Indian farming as well as agriculture. And we have our own small frames that we are carrying away as our imagination of what agriculture is about and what needs to be done about this. I'm not too sure whether the full picture would have fallen into place after these 2 days either, though you've done your best to, bring people who are looking mainly at numbers as well as people like Kiranjeet Ji, who's day in and day out interacting with the extreme manifestation of the agrarian distress in the country. Before I go to feminization of agriculture, which has been given as a topic for me, I'll take 1 minute to talk about myself and this network called ASHA, Alliance for Sustainable and Holistic Agriculture. And I would like to do so only to improve receptivity in the minds of a few people who have this strong belief that, you know, foreign funded NGOs are coming in the way of, you know, great agricultural development that is bound to take place if they were not there of the, or if they were not raising their voices this way. I'm not an NGO, I'm not foreign funded, I'm not salaried, I don't hold a job, and many of my colleagues in this platform called ASHA They're people who have actually given up lucrative careers to come back and do, come back from, you know, Switzerland, the US, a satellite communications engineer, a telecom engineer, an IT sector person, whoever it is. They've come back to do something for rural India and for farmers. If that helps in receptivity at all, I'd like you to keep your mind open about what people like us are saying. It's not because, you know, there's some funding that's asking us to do something. I also want to say that I have a small little toe in the field too, in a drought-prone district in Anantapur, where we work with women farmers and especially seek out those women farmers from farm suicide families. Anantapur is also a district which continues to see, I mean, just in the past 3-4 months, there were at least 300 suicides. And like Kiranjit ji, you know, I make my monthly visits there, and you can't do anything but just sit down with the woman and break down yourself, because that's something that's happening on a daily basis. And I think our views about what needs to be done very much relate to what you're getting to experience in terms of your direct relation with farmers. You could be a farmer yourself, but all others who are into policy making, I think which kind of farmer are you getting exposed to and so on matters a lot. And it's not out of place to, you know, remind ourselves about Gandhi's talisman of trying to remember the face of the poorest and weakest person of the day that you've met, and what is it that you've been able to do or you can do for that person. And I would really love it if, you know, I know it will become a tokenism, but if it's something that's hung in the rooms of all policymakers. Because, you know, there's one way of looking at numbers, and several numbers seem to be fabricated out there, which will make the averages look good, you know, if you can pull up one section. But this constant attention to that group of people who are probably pulling down your averages is probably what the focus should be, and that's where you know, Gandhi's talisman comes in. Okay, feminization of agriculture. You know, the economic survey also talked about feminization of agriculture this year, and the media talked about it big time. You know, even as it was being presented on the floor, you had all these flashing headlines talking about how Indian agriculture is getting more and more feminized. But the numbers actually don't bear it out. If there is any feminization at all in terms of macro data, it is getting reflected essentially in operational land holdings, that a slightly higher percentage of women are operating land holdings than they used to 5 years ago or 10 years ago. But other than that, whether you look at NSSO data or census data, we actually have a picture of women getting pushed out of agriculture. And there is enough information, I would think, from some analysis that some scholars have done, which is showing that the overall workforce decline, female workforce decline in India, is actually connected to the decline of female workforce in rural India, and that is getting driven by decline in agriculture. And scholars like Vikas Rawal have culled out from NSSO data to show that it's linked mainly to land disposition. And other than, you know, his earlier work that shows that, you know, there's mechanization, and I can't help but talk about herbicides as well as herbicide tolerant GM crops, you know, women in India find their largest source of employment to be agriculture. And when it comes to rural India, that's the mainstay for women there. And there, within agriculture, manual de-weeding is something that happens across all crops. Transplanting happens in some crops. Harvesting, of course, happens. But manual removal of weeds is a very, very important source of employment for rural women, for the poorest rural women. And if in this country we, we think about mission on mechanization and, you know, bring in other technologies like herbicide-tolerant GM crops without worrying about how do you provide alternative employment to such women, I think it's a big problem, and I think policymakers do have to pay attention to it. But going back to the fact that Census 2011 showing that for the first time, everyone noted this, that there's been an absolute decline in the number of cultivators. And one also found that the number of agricultural laborers had increased. But what wasn't discussed enough is the fact that the number of women cultivators has actually declined a lot more than the number of male cultivators. In the census, as everyone knows, this is a self-declaration by the respondent. It is not based on land records. So we do have a situation where within agriculture, lesser proportion of women than it was in 2001 are actually getting employed and engaged in agriculture. And in the overall scenario also, you can see that, there's more men employed in agriculture than women. But in terms of agriculture labor that goes in, it is so very clear that for every acre of land of any crop across any region of India, except for a new phenomenon that's cropping up, which is that of having to guard your crop against wild animals, where men are, sitting, sleeping in their fields night after night. It is women who put in a lot more work than men do. And there are numerous micro studies, time use studies, as well as, other micro studies, which are showing that 70% of labor that goes into growing any crop goes from women and not men. And unfortunately, except for one friend yesterday who in a parallel discussion brought up this radical idea that if we ever think of income transfers, it should be into a joint account and not the leave the woman out. All the references to farmers over yesterday and today were about the he's of the world. Our imagination is only about male farmers. I'm so very glad that you have a picture of a woman here, because very often you find that websites of government, PowerPoint presentations of people, imagination of a farmer is always about a man. Our references are all about the male pronouns. We are not even thinking about women, and this invisibility is what needs to be addressed. So we need more feminization. We actually need more feminization in another sense than it is usually used, that term, which is that we need women to be visibilized. We need women farmers to be explicitly talked about, acknowledged, recognized, and identified. And that brings us to a big problem, which is that in this country, the establishment looks at farmers as landowners. And we've been talking about it again and again. Even yesterday, we were talking about how do we identify the real farmers. And one doesn't mean just cultivators, but farmers of a variety of farming occupations. You find that that is something that we have not cracked, even though we have a policy for farmers for the very first time in independent India, 2007. This country came up with a national policy for farmers, and it had an exciting, expansive, progressive definition of who's a farmer. And that definition actually delinked land ownership from who gets to be called a farmer. You know, a beekeeper was defined as a farmer, an agricultural laborer was defined as a farmer, a forest gatherer was defined as a farmer, a livestock rearer was defined as a farmer, a tenant farmer was defined as a farmer, and pretty often women farmers fit into all these categories. But we haven't really figured out how to actualize this definition of a farmer into the entire establishment's thinking and create our results framework, documents also around how do we cater our schemes and policies and programs, and if required, even bring new legislations to cater to this imagination of a farmer. When you take the national policy for farmers, all women farmers are farmers in their own right, whether or not they own land ownership. But because the mindset is so steeped in looking at farmers only in relation to land ownership, we've got to do a few things for sure. One is, not just for agriculture reasons, but to empower women per se. I mean, how can this country, it's a no-brainer, right? You can't start talking about SDGs, you can't talk about equitable development and so on if you can't begin thinking about how will you take women along, especially the poorest women, rural women, marginalized women. And in that context, I do think we've got to get our asset ownership parity right. And for that to happen, one way of doing it is, of course, to implement the Hindu Succession Amendment Act much more rigorously. That will address a large number of private landowners in this country. Most households are Hindu. So, you would have, over a period of time, at least gone to a state where maybe there's 50-50% land ownership between men and women. And we don't have to look at asset only as land. I mean, we can even think about tools, machines, and so on, giving that visibility to farmers. But in the absence of an immediate overnight solution, that will take time. We do need to have a system of providing identity to women farmers. And we have been proposing, I also wear multiple caps. I also represent another platform called MAKAM, Mahila Kisan Adhikar Manch, which was formed about 4 years ago, just to visibilize the issues of women farmers. We've been asking for an identity card system to be instituted from the panchayat upwards. It's easy enough to get women to self-identify their category of farming. I could be a livestock rearer, come tenant farmer, come an agricultural laborer. And you issue identity cards. And I think coupled with that identity card, which gives you entitlement to various schemes and other services, it could be, just simple extension that reaches you also as a farmer. We could think about many other services around bankability of women farmers by instituting a credit guarantee fund that goes hand in hand with identity cards issued to women farmers. And, there are only 3-4 mechanisms by which the markets will start looking at women, not just the markets, in fact, even the state agencies will begin looking at women as farmers. One is that asset ownership, that identity. And a third system could be, this is something that we just discussed in a Ministry of Agriculture workshop on October 15th, which was marked as Women Farmers Day, is about how to bring more women farmers into groups. Because all said and done, the poorest, most assetless women in this country have proven that their repayment ability and discipline is far, far higher than, I'm taking names, your Ambanis, your Adanis, your Malyas, your whoever else who's gone away from this country. They have a record to show of 94% repayment as groups without any collateral other than each other, poor women. So the need to bring these women farmers into groups, either as self-help groups or joint liability groups which are not working that well. So one of the proposals that we have is that more and more joint liability groups should actually be carved out of SHGs as smaller groups, which makes them more credit worthy and bankable, as well as, you know, just skill certificates from several agencies which are running these courses. You know, maybe they're not teaching anything new. Maybe the women have a lot to teach to the course trainers and so on. I wish that would also be discussed at some point of time. But there are some mechanisms by which I think women as farmers can be made more visible as well as more credit worthy for their farming as well as their enterprises to take off. One other aspect that we keep talking about when we talk about women farmers is the fact that there's actually a masculinization trend. There's of course pockets of feminization in this country, but there's a masculinization trend where women are getting marginalized from decision making related to farming. And that's for a simple reason that there's a existing asymmetry when it comes to market interface between men and women, both at the input end and the output end. And in such a context, it does look like an ecological agriculture paradigm, depending on nature's free resources, depending on commons, is something that brings in a lot more equity than depending on markets. And therefore, to talk about ecological agriculture in the context of women farmers' vision, and this is not something that I am saying or I have put in the mouths of women farmers. In meeting after meeting, we hear women farmers demanding for another farming paradigm for themselves. And that could be because there are gendered roles that are already thrust on them related to food and nutrition security for the household, various practical needs that they have. So ecological agriculture paradigm has to be promoted on a large scale. And I also want to talk about, because we're talking about food systems and I heard no one else mention it, in our food security discourse, we've got to start looking at forests as food producing habitats. The most malnourished and undernourished communities in this country are actually forest dependent communities. And we have successfully broken the link between that forest, agriculture and food systems continuum that used to exist in their context by doing a variety of wrong things, and to be able to look at forests as those habitats that provide uncultivated, free, organic, accessible to everyone foods is a very important thing that we've got to discuss in the food security discourse in this country. I've been involved in a research project for 8 months in Raigada district in Odisha, where we used 2-3 different methodologies, some PRA methodologies to find out what are the perceptions and what's the level of importance that people give to forest foods compared to various other food sources. We measured by spring balances how much forest gathering happens to this day, and it's dependent on various factors, of course, what kind of a forest, how far is it, all those things. But we also measured the proportion of uncultivated forest food in cooked, consumed foods of people. And in that study, we found up to 24% of what they consume is actually forest foods across different months. And these are extremely nutritious foods. Nutritional analysis of these foods exists, rich in micronutrients and so on. I do think we've got to think about how do we conserve dense forests, diverse forests, for achieving nutrition security for the most marginalized and voiceless in this country, and not just look at the mines under those trees. I will stop there. Sorry, one last thing. I'm being hurried up by the chair and just want to say one thing. The problem whenever you speak about women in this country, and that happens in the context of women farmers also, is the lack of gender disaggregated data. Our land records, for decades there's been a discussion, but they can't simply add one more column in the basic land records, you know, serial number, name of the landowner, sex of the landowner. No, you don't want to make that simple change. Similarly, RBI collects data from banks about male and female account holders and all of that, but never puts it out in the public domain. I think unless we resolve this problem of gender disaggregated data being missing, we won't be able to track any progress. I'll stop there. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Kavita. We have a little bit of time for question answers. It'll be standing between you and lunch, but please go ahead and ask them questions. Yes, ma'am.
This question is addressed to... This question is addressed to Kavita. I'd just like to know, because at one point of time, you were also involved...
Just put the mic up.
Speak into the mic.
One time, we were involved in collecting various kinds of data from the forest, but these are totally inaccessible. Even to get the data, I mean, you're just not allowed. So I wonder how to get the food out of those forests. I mean, like, it's totally inaccessible. It's highly protected and everything. So I really do not know how we can capture.
Well, there used to be a time in this country when the forest department was the greatest oppressor of Adivasi community members. But the access for minor forest produce is much more easier now than it used to be a few decades ago. And it's very much possible to collect data.
Any other questions? Yes, answer.
I can speak loud.
You speak into the microphone.
Recording.
When you say that farmers should get income, assured income, monthly income, the immediate question comes to raised is that, you know, what they contribute. Whether the income you ask is proportional to their contribution. So here lies the great, grave mistakes, erroneous, deliberate in calculating what is called the national income. What they say is what the 15% or 14% is the agriculture or farmers' contribution. There lies a mistake. A mistake is a deliberate one. It is the maize is the contribution, not the conflict. It is the sugarcane is the contribution of the farmer, not the ethanol, rectified spirit, molasses. It is the barley is the contribution, not the beer, rum, the brandy. It is only the cotton is the contribution, and not the cloth, garment, apparel, and pants. So definitely you have the reservation on the GDP, but you blame the GDP for the right reason. So while you may, the farmer's data set, except in case of the computers and the mobile, so we are making contribution in each and every goods and services we have been consuming. So once the real contribution is known in terms of the so-called, it is basically national income, so then you will have the legitimate right to ask what is the real share in the so-called national income and the income part. Thank you.
You're very right, Professor. I remember US study which says that the share of agriculture in the US economy is 4% on GDP is 4%. You know, in India it is still 14% or 13%, whatever you say. But there it is 4%. And yet America is putting so much of effort to protect its agriculture. Now, but what is missing there? There's a study by one of the universities there which says that the share of agriculture in the economy is 60% in America. And I'm sure your own studies, if I look at it, it shows very clearly that, you know, the share of agriculture in India's economy also may be more than a 90%. And I think this has to be accepted. And then only we can, of course, work out what is the contribution of farmers in the total economy. But the other part is when you say 14%, the share of normally, but we try to work it out is, oh, agriculture share is 14% of the GDP, so we don't have to worry about agriculture, is because you are not paying in agriculture. You are not paying farmers their due. So obviously, if you were to pay their dues, their contribution will also go up. You have been denying their due, denying them their rightful due, and that is why their share is coming down. If we were, just like, look at the Seventh Pay Commission jacks up the GDP share also, doesn't it? So if we were to pay more to the farmers, their share would definitely go up. And more is also the problem with the investments in agriculture, which of course has been declining over the last four decades of our decades. So if they were both to simultaneously go up, the public sector investment as well as the income of the farmers, and in the way that you work it out, that, you know, the share of sugarcane, for instance, sugarcane farmers in the I've seen one of your studies, is what exactly has to be known.
We'll take that as the last question.
Kavita, just a small observation. You spoke about the role of women workforce in agriculture.
You speak into the microphone.
Yeah, Kavitaji, you spoke about the role of women workforce in Indian agriculture. I entirely admit, and you talked about the de-weeding as one of the operations. Should we also not think of reducing the drudgery in the women workforce?
We certainly need to. I think what we really need to focus on is drudgery reducing tools and machines, appropriate technology, but not employment displacing. That's the fine balance that needs to be struck.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the concluding remarks, and I hand over the proceedings to Mr. Nanda Kumar. Thank you. David? Okay. We have scheduled 15 minutes for this session.
Yeah, 10-15.
Ajay?
Ajay.
Yeah. So we will keep it to that 15 minutes.
Yes.
Both of us don't have many long speeches. First, I think I should compliment Ajay Jakhar. Because at least I don't remember an occasion where so many different views have been brought onto the same platform. And I think, where is Viju? Viju said something about you can disagree, but you can also agree on one or two very important things. So I would wish that this dialogue continues, because yesterday in one of the sessions, I was telling people how difficult it is even for senior civil servants dealing with agriculture to be heard within the government. So it's time that the voices are louder, clearer, and heard. Now, how we make that happen, there are many ways of doing it. I suppose each group, each person has his own choice. The second, I think, is a good takeaway, which I'm sure David would probably highlight, is that agriculture, as we did in this country, needs a paradigm shift. Now, that shift, I think I started by saying that shift, we'll have to look at farmers' prosperity. That shift has to look at nutrition for the poorer people, poorer sections of people, whether it's gender specific or not, and also look at the challenges of the climate. So probably the way we do R&D, the way we do policy, the way we do many things that has taken us this far needs a complete rethink. And I would also argue that the time to break silos between nutrition, agriculture, food has also come. And that's the more difficult challenge, because government departments are not easy to handle. I wish Ramesh Chand had responded to that challenge that I posed to him. We did that successfully within agriculture in 2008-09, when we did the RKBY, where we said the farmer is everybody who includes a beekeeper to a livestock farmer. I do hope that, David, your presence here has triggered something new, some new thinking, and people who have been here in different capacities will take this forward, take this dialogue forward, and understand that what we are trying to do together is for the largest good of the largest poorer people in this country. And I think that's probably a political statement, but I think even politicians would love to do that. So, but I would also like to respond very briefly to what Karanjit said. I think in government, we have lost our ability to listen. And I think it's an extremely important message that she has brought here, that at every level of policy and implementation, can we spend a little more time listening to people? And I think a lot of correction would then happen. Now, I don't want to prolong this debate any longer.
I would hand over to David for sum up, and I'm sure you will come again, and we will have this dialogue going probably, I don't know, next year, maybe 6 months later, whenever that happens.
Right. Well, thank you very much indeed, Mr. Nam Kumar. This won't be a long final statement, because the dialogue will continue, and I know it will continue. So this is merely me offering you some remarks under six headings as we reach this point on our journey. The first is that this use of the term food systems is quite deliberate, because it's asking us all to see food in a really broad way that includes but goes beyond agriculture. And I'm going to add to it that what we've been discussing today is food systems that are good for people and good for the planet. And I'm really pleased that during the discussions over the 2 days, the role of people in food systems has received so much attention. Number two, in 2015, world leaders agreed on the Sustainable Development Agenda. Some of you will have seen my little lapel pin. This is a sign of the goals in the Sustainable Development Agenda that were agreed by all 193 leaders of our world. These, in my view, are really important. But there's another part of that agreement that I want to highlight. The world leaders said, we will focus on everybody, leaving no one behind. And that means focusing on the people who live below the median. And I'm very pleased that in these discussions today, we have started to really concentrate not on the average, but on everyone, with a special focus on those whose position is not good. Those people who do not come in to a meeting like this, but who depend on us to think about them and have them at the center of our minds. My third point. I think it has been very important that we have had these strong points, strong sessions, strong statements about the reality that food systems are really all about women. Women do the caring, women look after nourishing, women do a lot of work in agriculture, women are at the center of ensuring the future viability of society. You said it all. I thought that your presentation were very powerful, and I personally will take it away very much the center of my heart. So thank you for bringing out the importance of thinking very precisely about what is happening to women and whether or not women are able to play their part in the making of decisions about food, about nutrition, and about the planet. I particularly noted your point that women are often at the forefront of discussions about the way in which nature is being handled in agriculture, and I'm very, very keen to continue that discussion. My fourth point. I am concerned that the term farmer is so often applied to the person who is looking after a plot of land and growing rice or wheat or other crops. increasingly I'm using the term people who farm. And by saying people who farm, I mean people who farm from the forest, people who farm in the water, people who farm animals, and people who farm crops or vegetables or fruits or nuts or pulses or whatever else. Because I think the need to recognize that farming covers so much more than crops is absolutely vital. And if we can do whatever is possible to recognize that these people who farm are also the people who sustain nature and also the people who do a lot of caring for others, then we will recognize they are central to the future of society and of humanity. And thank you for bringing those points up. And if we're going to say that people who farm have all these roles in society, then we will have to break down the silos between our different professional disciplines and build bridges across so that these people who farm are seen as central to the future of humanity and of the planet. My fifth point. Sometimes when I talk with others about the kind of issues we've been discussing today, people look at me and they say, isn't it all terribly complicated? Why don't you simplify things and just focus on one particular area? I say, life is complicated, and it's important that we who are making policy decisions, we who are working in government or in international organizations, we have to show that we are capable of embracing complexity and not running away from it. As you leave these dialogues, please feel comfortable about complexity. Please don't be scared of it, because that is the world in which we are living. One other point about this is please be comfortable about putting life into food systems, whether it is people, whether it is animals, whether it is insects, whether it is fungi. All the work we're doing is about life. And that is so important, because then once we realize we're talking about living systems, we don't dissolve just into talking about crops or talking about the economics or markets. We recognize that this is about life and living, and we really have to keep that going. But if we're going to do that, we've got to be able to listen. To listen to the individuals, to listen to what is happening in society, and to be able to feel it in our hearts, as well as to study it with our eyes and our brains. And during these dialogues over 2 days, I felt something rather magic in this room. It is a real recognition of the importance of people and of life within the systems that we are discussing. And I thank you very much indeed for doing that. And so to my last point, how am I going to be feeling as I leave at the end of these 2 remarkable days? I'm feeling hugely grateful to all of you for sharing so much with me. And I hope that you are feeling pleased as well that you've been part of this moment of sharing. And if you feel it's a good thing, I hope you will take the spirit of this broad dialogue done in such a respectful way, even though we don't agree, done in a way that makes us feel confident that we can talk to each other. It's what you were talking about, Mr. Krishnan, Dr. Krishnan. You were talking about issue-based unity. And perhaps that was the thing that really struck me today, that even though each of us has a different view on life, each of us works for a different organization, we are united by the issue that we believe that it's right to be working for the future of food systems that respect life and respect people, because we know that is key for the future. So if you feel like I feel, please take this idea and try it out in different places and see whether it works. See whether it is going to lead to something that is just better, not just for India, but better for the world. So much goodness has come out of India for our world, and you could possibly take this way of working that Ajay has brought to us and take it elsewhere. So thank you. I am so indebted. Thank you very much.
The last word. I have lost my voice for the last 2 days, but I hope farmers have gained a much bigger voice in the policy debate. Thank you, David. Thank you, Nankumali. Thank you, everyone, for being here and being here with us. And we hope a lot of you will be there next month for the walk also. Thank you so much.